WSOP? I guess so. What's going on, guys? We're here. We're live. Welcome to a brand new Poker Live podcast. My name is Joey Grimone, aka Chicago Joey. Joined today by a young gentleman who, if I had him on a couple months ago when we initially planned this, this whole entire podcast would be completely different. But now he's Mr. Martial Arts, Mr. Fucking Professional Fighter.
No, I'm not.
Okay, he's an amateur fighter, but he's also known for his very long time in the online poker world. He's been are you still a heads up sit and go online end boss, Olivier? I wasn't sure.
It depends what you mean by end boss. Like, yeah, I win and I can play, but I don't open sit the 5Ks. Open sitting the 5Ks is a different level of online player. It's Jungle, right. It's Ike, it's OTB Red Baron, it's some really good guys.
Okay, so competing at the 5Ks, but not open sitting them still. But
my record against them, I've crushed that group, destroyed them. But I'm humble enough to know that, you know, it's probably a short-lived variance result.
But are people going to know you as the poker player who took this fight now? Or are they going to not know you for your many, many years of success in the online poker world, your inclination, like Dan Coleman? Shout out to Dan we had him on the podcast.
What's up, Dan Coleman?
You guys both enjoy chatting in a maybe not friendly way in the chat box, correct?
Oh, totally different though. Totally different. He's like a troll who's like I don't know what he does now, but he, like, in his prime, he was a troll, like, owning people in the chat. I was, like, actually getting frustrated, and, like, it was affecting my play, so I had to just completely get rid of that, like, ban my chat, and I'm very happy if people do not associate that with me. But, yeah, Dan was on another level. Dan was, like, owning, you know, I used to watch Dan play 5K heads up sit and goes, and he would have chat roulette on at the same time, and he would just be like trolling the people in chat roulette while he was playing like two tabling 5Ks. Like, he's an animal. He really is like crazy dude.
So is Dan one of those? Is he one of those guys on chat roulette? You know that's like the naked.
No,
I don't know what he does. I could see that for sure. I could see Dan.
No, that's doing just that. Like, when that happens, you just like snap skip to the next person. But there are some regular people who are just like, I mean, I don't know anymore. I didn't really pay attention to it.
Wait, how were you like a chat roulette grinder back in the day or something like that, or what?
Yeah, I literally never went on the site once. I didn't even know what it was. And then I'm like, who are you talking? I'm like across from him. And I'm like, he's on the table. And I'm like, who are you talking to? And he's like, oh, I'm on this thing called chat roulette. It's like really hilarious. And then I would go around and random people would be on, and he would just be fucking with them. But at the same time, he's playing 5Ks. It was actually really entertaining. We used to get such a kick out of him doing that shit.
If only they had something like Twitch or something back then where people were they were more recording themselves back then, or they weren't really recording themselves back then. Like, there's so many things that I did with poker. I wish I would have recorded in this whole like Twitch time and screen saving, sharing, whatever, recording times. But I feel like people missed out on a lot of fun times for sure.
I think people don't realize like how entertaining in that capacity Dan like would be. He's a character.
Yeah, he certainly seemed like a character from having audio. Obviously, I didn't know too much about him, and I think a lot of people didn't know much about him. And it seems like the feedback from that episode, a lot of people certainly changed the viewpoint that they might have had on him.
Yeah,
after the one drop stuff happened.
Yeah, I think people just, you know, people take limited amount of information and then try to make like serious conclusions about other people. And it was like, I think most people misunderstood that whole one drop thing. And even if you did understand it, it doesn't tell you a lot about what he's like, you know. It doesn't just tells you that he doesn't like a lot of attention.
I mean, listen to that. It's not, if you listen to what people say on social media, they knew 100% what his character, they knew everything about the motherfucker
Media people know everything about everything. So
I mean, listen, Olivia, we're gonna get into this. They allegedly been knowing a lot about you too.
They know a shit ton about me. My story's been written already.
I don't know. I've been reading the forums lately. Now they seem to know a lot about this fight. We're gonna talk about this in a little bit. But guys, if you can't be bothered to watch this, I'll put in recaps, timestamps up. I'll post it on my website, onepokerlife.com. I'll put the timestamps in the description for this after the fact as well too. So people, if they, you know, they don't want to watch the whole thing through, you can go click there and click around and stuff like that. And then you can find the podcast on iTunes, and that's all I got to say, really. So let's get into it, man. What do you want to start? You want to start with the fight? You want to go with the fight? You're also, by the way, you're on like a
pod, yo, Poppy. I'm happy to do it. You lead the dance.
You know, you've been uh, You've been kind of like a porn star lately in a way too. You're on like a little, you're getting gangbanged by the podcast world and poker, it seems like, now this week, huh?
Whoa.
Yeah, you're getting, yeah. I normally like to be the first guy in, but I'm like the second guy in, and now there's some people I see lined up the third and fourth guys in. I mean,
I gotta say, I had to give Elliot the first shot. You know, Elliot was my mind coach my mental coach for the fight, and I was just like, he earned that first shot. I wanted to do this pod for a long, long time, but I almost feel like, you know, when somebody like writes a book and then they do all the like the rounds of the talk shows, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? Then you see them like on late night or on the Daily Show or all the shit. And it was like, that's how I feel. Like every media outlet is like, hey, you're the latest person that anybody gives a shit about. Like, come on and talk about it.
have you been contacted by anyone outside of like any media people outside of poker too?
No. I've rarely, if ever, been able to cross that barrier. That's a tough barrier to cross.
Hollywood Haxton's done it some. I mean, I feel like a fight for...
Well, Hollywood Haxton is another level.
Yeah, he. I don't even know how Hollywood Haxton got on Joe Rogan, but I should have asked him exactly how that came to be when I had him on the pod. But
I'm surprised you didn't. I'm curious about that too.
I mean, once you got... We were an hour in, I was pretty drunk. So I think we were just sort of... There wasn't any looking at notes at that point. We were just sort of going off of whatever was in my mind. So... It's a different vibe when that happens. But yes, I feel like with, you know, it was so publicized and the amount of money, a little bit unusual for a fight, I guess you could say. Maybe not for a professional fight, but certainly for an amateur fight, it seems like it's probably one of the higher stakes amateur fights that's going to take place this year that we're going to know about. So,
I mean, I think it's a lot of money even for a pro fight.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at some of the alleged pays, the pace range that the UFC guys are getting paid, it's certainly... You guys definitely were playing for more than most of those guys can potentially earn.
If those guys lose, they don't have to pay.
Well, I guess that's very... I mean, I wonder if how they'd want to take... If they take the fight, if they had to pay, if they lost too.
I mean, you know, a lot of those guys don't have a ton of money. So, I mean, they can't... I don't think they can afford to just, like, lose the money if they lose the fight. That would be just crazy.
I guess you could be like poker where you get backed by people. Like, you sell it to your camp and, like... You have people come in and you have like fundraiser. I mean, maybe you can do the thing on Twitter. I saw someone, I'm going to send a shot. I saw someone on Twitter recently trying to, that's not a shot. He's trying to raise a fund. Like okay. You could try to raise a fund on Twitter for like to fight people or something. I mean, it's an idea.
A fight fund?
Well, I mean, I'm thinking about it from like a poker, maybe just instead of poker, okay. Make it for a fight. You could bet money on a fight or something like that.
Yeah, I mean. I don't know.
I'm brainstorming ideas, trying to think of ways to make some extra money for people out there. So, all right, let's talk about the fight. So you put up, for those who don't know, I'll give some quick cliff notes. So JC gave you odds. You came in 22 pounds heavier than he did.
Yep.
You put up 120K. He put up 160K, correct?
150.
150.
Yep.
Okay, so I wrote about this. It seemed like you probably had more action than that, though.
Yeah, I had more action. I had more. I don't really want to get into how much. I'll just say that, like, as time went on, I got more and more confident. And at the end, I felt like this was, like, the best equity spot that I might ever find in my life.
Mm. It certainly seemed that from the way you were, like, just from observing from, like, my perspective on Twitter, the way that you were, like, really going after action, I'm like, Jesus Christ. I mean, he, like, Hollywood Haxton's on this side of the betting, but... I mean, the amount of grinding you were doing to get more action, I was just like, I mean, he's got to be extremely confident right now.
Yeah, I mean, I think you have to be a little bit careful about, like, putting people up on a pedestal, right? Like, so I think I'm not in love with the idea of being on the opposite side of Ike on a bet, but at the same time, like, this is not Ike's, like, area of expertise. I mean, everybody makes mistakes and everybody is susceptible to bias. Mm-hmm. So like, I think there is an entire group of people who just kind of misjudged the situation.
They misjudged the situation and they got punished by losing some money, it seemed like, so.
Yeah, I think they can afford it though.
Yeah, you never know these days, never know these days. But a lot of the focus poppy's been on this, been on some other things related to the fight, my friend. You've been reading the forums, you've been reading Twitter, you've been seeing some of the comments here, huh?
Are you talking about the PED and steroid allegations?
Well, that's what I'm talking about, kid. I mean, listen, I'm not an expert. I'm not going to pretend to be an expert, but the guys in the forums.
Look, there's a lot of, a lot of 2+2 experts, a lot of experts on 2+2. So you can just read the forums and you'll have all the expertise you need.
Listen, I would normally not think steroid experts are hanging out and news gossip on a poker forum, but the way that these guys talk, I gotta say that they're making me convinced that they are professional experts who have been judging steroids for many years. So
yeah,
how can I be inclined to want to not believe these guys, right?
All right, so I would say I'm gonna respond in like two ways. One is like this kind of meta way, and then two is like I'll get into the nitty gritty. Okay.
Okay.
So like from a meta point of view, like. What I've noticed is like whenever anybody has like success, there's a small group of people, you know, you can call them haters, who basically just want to take credit away from that person. And they just are unwilling or unable to accept that sometimes the answer actually just is like hard work and commitment and dedication. For whatever reason, maybe that, you know, their own issues, I just noticed that as a pattern over and over again. In terms of like me actually, like what I did, first of all, I was like 185 pounds when I made the bet and probably like 190 pounds when I walked into the cage. I had been doing bodybuilding type lifting for about 2 years with a trainer 4 or 5 times a day before I made the bet. And I was as big as I am now, pretty much. I then started when the fight started, I had a strength and conditioning guy, and he told me to take creatine, which like automatically makes you gain some weight. Glutamine, I took liquid BCAAs, and I took animal pack, which is like this vitamin pack from GNC. I thought that our agreement with JC, it's like really weird to put it this way, I'll explain why, but I thought our agreement was that we wouldn't take anything that you couldn't buy at a GNC, and we would have a gentleman's agreement. And he said the reason for that was because testing was very expensive. I didn't really know what that meant for testing to be very expensive, but like just as a area of like comparison, we didn't even escrow money. So the idea that like steroids would be a gentleman's agreement, I didn't think was that weird. I was just like, yeah, I'm not gonna do anything. He was like, yeah, I'm not gonna do anything. We were like, yeah, okay, we trust each other. Then I released those pictures on Twitter, and I can get into why I did that, but I released those pictures on Twitter and they got a lot of like, you know, responses on Twitter, right? People say a lot of different shit. And he didn't reply or even favorite any responses except for two of them. And both of the responses that he favorited, I like basically said, accused me of being on PEDs or steroids. So I messaged him and I was like, yo, I don't know why you decided to engage this way by not replying or favoriting anything but these two steroid based tweets. But if you have any concerns, I'm happy to get tested. I'm happy to like, you know, I haven't done anything, and anything that you want to do to like ensure that I haven't, I'm cool with. And he responded in a way that I found really odd, because he said, look, we agreed not to test, so I don't even consider it cheating. And I was like, whoa, whoa, whoa. We agreed not to test, but we also agreed not to do anything. So it sounds really weird when you're saying I don't consider it cheating. I felt two things. One, that's good, because later on, I'm safe from any sort of accusation of steroids, because I have written from him, I don't consider it cheating. So I don't even have to deal with anything else. I have that saves me. But two, that made me think, well, what is he taking, right? If he's, maybe that's a way for him to get out of taking something. Then he told me this long story about how his strength and conditioning coach, when he was training with Roble, advised him to take something, like take some anabolic stuff, and said that a bunch of stuff he could recommend wouldn't show up on tests. And then JC told me how he was like offended by that. He fired that guy. He didn't want to take any of that stuff. That just like, that was bullshit. So I was like, so that made me think that, okay, maybe he's being legit and honest, and we just had a miscommunication about what we had agreed upon. But it didn't matter to me. I had no interest in taking anything. I was super confident doing what I was doing, and things were like going really well. So I was just like, okay, whatever. Then he tells me that despite this, he's over 85% sure that I have some juice flowing through my veins. And I was just like, how could you come up with that specific number? How could it be so high? I was just like, really, I didn't understand that at all. He said he showed my picture to a couple people, and they were like, a couple like professionals, and they were like, look at his lats. Like, clearly he's fucking juicing. And I was just like, it was one of those things, like, you know, the movie My Cousin Vinny?
I haven't seen that in a long time. I probably okay, think I saw that when I was a young kid.
There's a scene in My Cousin Vinny where Joe Pesci's like talking to these two kids who are accused of murder, and he's actually using a playing card, and he's like, we know that the prosecution's case is bullshit. And he like turns the playing card and he's like, because we know that you're innocent. It's like, you know, I'm sitting there, I have all the information. Like, I know that I didn't take anything, and I'm listening to this guy formulate this convoluted and complicated argument about how obvious it is that I've taken shit, and I just know that I haven't. I'm just like laughing at this bullshit. I'm just like, this is complete nonsense. So anyway, I gained 4 or 5 pounds in 6 months, and I was taking creatine, which I think is pretty normal. I heard some people on the forum say, you can't gain weight while you do MMA training. It's just not possible. Like, I don't even understand why they think that's true. Like, my guess is somebody like Carlos Condit or GSP do a ton of extra outside the gym cardio work, running, swimming, biking. I didn't do any of that shit. The reason I didn't do any of that shit, because my MMA coach told me, we have marathon runners come in here and they get tired after 3 minutes. And the reason is because this is like non-transferable cardio. He doesn't put it like that, but that's what he means. He's like, the only way to get in shape for this is to do this. So he was like, you don't need to run. You don't need to do any of that shit. And I was like, okay. So I didn't do any, like, I did very little. I probably ran under 6 or 7 times. I still did a little bit of running, especially at the end, because I got kneed in the face and I had to get stitches twice. The second time was like 3 weeks before the fight. So I couldn't spar in like a couple weeks after that. And then I was really concerned about my cardio, and my cardio wasn't that great. And so I did some running during the last couple of weeks, but I really didn't do that much running. And, you know, I ate a ton, and, you know, that's just, I don't know, that's just how my body looks. I mean, you know, I don't really know what to say.
Yeah, I think a lot of people are saying that, you know, taking creatine or taking, you know, glutamine, animal packs, a combination of those supplements, that's not going to get someone making that sort of transformational difference. I don't know if there's any before photos of you,
so I can,
or anything like that.
So the transformation that people are talking about is real. It's just 3 years old. So like, I was 175. I was 170 pounds like 3 years ago for sure. But I tore my ACL and then I started lifting, and that's when I hired a trainer and was working out 4 or 5 times a day for like 2 years. And I gained 15 or 16 pounds during that time. There wasn't that much of a transformation from the beginning of the bet to the end. And I do have a picture. I actually texted a picture to Jason Mercier, and I still have it. I can send it to you. And it's like, I still have the long hair. So before I cut my hair, it was like a couple weeks into the fight, and like, I'm jacked in the picture. And I was like, yo, Jay, start making bets. Cause I'm coming for this thing, you know? So I mean, yeah, that like the transformation is not as much as people think. Also, like, there's a couple reasons why I think I look bigger than I actually am. One is because I just don't have much fat. And then two is because I have like the right kind of body to make myself look big, like small joints that make your muscles look bigger, relatively speaking. I never got above like 191 during the entire last 6 months. So I don't know. I think for me, it's like, I know that, you know, I remember on 2+2 a bunch of years ago, my account got hacked, and somebody free wrote, like, joyrided my Full Tilt account for 100,000, and I lost 100,000. And I was like super fucking obviously annoyed by that. And I had to deal with people on 2+2 saying, this guy is such a dick in the chat. He's such a douchebag. He probably just tilted and then is now blaming it on a hacker. And that was like, that was for me like the cementing moment of like 2+2, where I was just like, yeah, okay, this place is just like absurd. Whatever, it is what it is. The steroid thing for me is a little bit annoying because it takes something that was super meaningful to me and it tries to kind of take credit away or like make it seem like I did something that was like unethical. And I just didn't. And even though JC didn't consider it cheating, like, you know, if I say that I didn't do something and people say that I'm lying, it's kind of, you know, it's an attack on my integrity. So that whole thing it is what it is. It's not a big deal. I think it's a small group of people with, you know, larger loud voices. But yeah, I can just put it to rest. I did not take anything that you can't buy at a GNC.
I think that's what I was going to say. It's, you know, the people that are the most vocal about this stuff, you know, the people that are think you aren't, or, you know, they're just not going to waste their time to argue with people who are so aggressive on their, you know, on their opinion about this particular subject.
Yeah. And so confident.
Right. I mean, you know, shout out to some of those guys. Some of those guys, you know, I know they watch podcasts. I know they're fans of the podcast as well too, who are posting in that thread too. So, you know, I mean, you know, what can you really do? I guess all you can do is you can state exactly what you just stated. You know, I mean, I guess you can do the test, or you can, you know, you show your balls. I mean, I'm a ball shrink allegedly on steroids. You know, I can't, I mean, I can actually confirm that that is true for certain ones, but you know, like what can you do besides that? There really isn't much you can do. You can say what you say, and that's pretty much all you can go from.
Yeah. I mean, I offered on Twitter today, like 10 to one on someone who wants to pay for a test, but very quickly, you know, a couple people pointed out that it would be easy to pass the test even if I had done that. And like, I don't even know that because I don't have any fucking knowledge of this shit. I have like no, it's just not something I know anything about, but whatever. You're right. It's that's what I can do is explain my point of view and then move on.
Yeah. I mean, obviously I know from, you know, from reading, you know, reading the blog that you put out, by the way, that was a great piece of writing. If you haven't checked that out, go check it out on it. What's your blog? What's your Olivier Fight blog? What is it? OlivierFightBlog.wordpress.com.
Yeah, it's, I'll put a link in a pinned tweet so people can find it. It's somewhere on my Twitter. But I'll do that. It'll be the easiest way for people to find it.
We are live on YouTube. We're live on Twitch. Jay Lawrence said, Joey just made that up to see his balls. You guys got me. You're right. I'm trying to get Olivier to flash his balls here. Yeah. You guys, you figure it out. I appreciate the viewers that we got watching this live here, man. Much love to you guys. Shout out to everybody on YouTube. If you guys have any questions, comments, go ahead and put them in the chat. Shout out to my girl Jen. What's up, Jen Poppy? All right, man. So you
know, why can't I see the chat?
I mean, you could see the site. You are a known multitasker as well too. Do you want me to send you the links for the chat on YouTube and Twitch?
Yeah, I mean,
okay. Oh, you sure? I mean, you don't want to read some of this shit. I mean, hey,
I'm all good. Yo, my skin is very thick. I'm cool. Okay. I'm cool. I want to engage with the people. So I want to give shout outs too.
All right, you can some shout outs too. The chat can be distracting though. It's a very GTO way of managing the chat, but I feel like a kid like yourself, put in long hours, knowing how to multi-table, know how to look at it.
I'm not even good at multi-tabling.
Oh my God! Well, you're gonna be fishing hard with this, son. Hold on, let me send you a link. I'm gonna give you the YouTube link. I can't give you the Twitch. There's just guys are out of control in here.
Is it really that bad?
I mean, it's okay. It's not like some of the other Twitch streams on here, but it, you know, it could be.
All right, that's all good.
Yeah, when you said you weighed 190, I was like, how the fuck does he weigh? You weigh like 5 pounds more than me. I'm like, how can we weigh this? I know you're. I think we're about the same height. I might be a little bit taller than you, but
how tall are you?
Like 6'2"?
Yeah, I'm like 6'1".
Yeah, I was like, how the fuck is he? You only weigh 7 pounds more than me, man. I was like, God, now I know, I gotta like take some of this. I don't know where I gotta take things from to get that size, but I mean, I'm down. I'm ready to try to make that happen.
Below my knee, super skinny. My calves and shit, super skinny.
Mm. How are your, upper legs? Are they, I mean, they, I would assume they're pretty strong.
They're better now. Like a lot of my strength conditioning was by basically the main, I did kind of four main, lifts, which were squats, deadlifts, bench press, and, clean and press. Those are the four main things I did, but a lot of squats and deadlifts. Cause those were my weakest muscle groups on a relative basis, like going in, like my strength and conditioning guy was like, your lower back is like scary how weak it is. It's like you need to get that shit going.
Yeah, so. I think that's one of the first things when my trainer told me was I needed to start focusing on doing more deadlifts and squats just in general, because if you make that stronger, if you do those workouts, it's going to improve your strength and all these other workouts. And I'm like, I mean, it doesn't make much sense, but okay, I'll try it. And then it turns out it seems true for me.
Well, I think it also boosts your testosterone.
Hmm.
Yeah. Does which it? Is a natural steroid.
Hmm. You're on natural steroids during the fight. Is that what you're trying to say? Okay.
Yeah, I mean, I'm pretty sure my testosterone was higher 6 months, you know, into fight training. I'm pretty sure.
Okay. Natural steroids. Okay. They're going to go with that one, Olivia. I'm proud of you.
Yeah, I'm sure they're going to have a field day with that one.
What did you, on the other podcast you did, what did you mainly talk about? Did you talk about a lot of fight specific stuff on with Elliot and with the fine doctor?
Yeah, we talked about, yeah, a bunch of fight specific stuff. So stuff having to do with my training and, just like my kind of how I felt and my mental state kind of going in.
Okay. Kind of mental game. That makes sense. Yeah. Mainly mental stuff. I guess, I was thinking about where I wanted to go in terms of what I want to dig more into. Let's just talk about the blog post you made and talk about the reason for doing the fight. Someone in the chat, let me get the person's name here. Shout out to Mary, and I can't even say that last name. Hello, where are you from, bro? I've read his blog, but still didn't understand the reason for the fight. Just because of the divorce and wanting to prove every man needs to defend himself. It was a lot of violence in the fight. No shit. Okay, so reason for the fight. It was.
Well, that's the thing. It's like I can't just boil it down to a single reason. I would say it was a combination of a bunch of things. One was I've always wanted to learn how to fight. It's just always a thing I wanted to learn how to do. Two, like I felt like the training itself would be, I don't want to say miserable, but like really, really hard. And I felt like, so I talk about kind of trying to develop discipline in my blog because, I mean, you know, like when you play poker for a living, you can just do whatever the fuck you want, whenever you want to do. And I think you develop bad habits by living that life, or you can develop bad habits. I mean, I think I did. And I got to a point where if I didn't want to do some shit, I just didn't do it. And I think having the discipline to be able to do the things that you don't want to do in order to pursue a long-term goal is just like key to being successful and achieving in essentially like any capacity, right? In anything you want to do. And I was a little concerned with myself, especially as I consider transitioning out of poker. I was just concerned that, you know, maybe I had some bad habits that I needed to try to address. So having a project in which I knew that a decent amount of it would include things that I might wake up in the morning and be like, I really don't want to do this right now. And forcing myself to do it over and over again, could it start to instill good kind of discipline-based habits? And then I think, like I said, when I first had the idea, and the idea itself is a little bit of a crazy idea, but when I put it out on Twitter, it was kind of a feeler. I wasn't like, yeah, I'm down to do this. Let's do this for real. I just wanted to see what the response would be. And then that changed after JC said he was interested and we started to negotiate, because that turned from a feeler into like this thing that could really happen. And then when that happened, I noticed a change in how I felt about the situation. And I started to feel some real anxiety about it. I started to feel this, like, I don't want to say panic, but like this level of fear associated with doing this. And it wasn't this fear about, you know, maybe he'll break my nose, or, you know, maybe I'll be embarrassed in front of the poker community, or, you know, maybe I'll lose the money. It wasn't about that. It was just something that was just there with me, and I felt it physically, and it was just like in my mind. And when I talk about my divorce, I think it's just because I happened to be at a point in time where I was really trying to think about the kind of person that I was, that I had been, and that I wanted to be, and that, you know, what changes I needed to make and who I wanted to be going forward. And so I just think I happened to be in a spot where I interpreted that fear and how I was going to react to it in a way that was like, you're either going to like figure out a way out of this, like slither your way out of this, or you're going to like step up and face it. And it was like, I don't know exactly why my subconscious presented it that way to myself, but that's how it did. And then I was like, okay, well, maybe I didn't think this through that well in the beginning, but now that I've perceived it in this way, we're going to go for it. Like, we're going to do it. And I had had enough discussion with JC at the time that I felt like I wasn't getting sandbagged, that I wasn't in a spot against a guy that I had no chance against. I was like, knowing myself and knowing how I'm going to deal with this project, and the emotional place that I'm in, where I know that I can like really channel my energy into a single, you know, a singular focus. I'm not going to be distracted by other shit. I know that I can like really put myself forward into one thing. I just had this faith that I would figure it out and get to the place that I needed to get to. And then, you know, there's also this element of it being a physical challenge. I wanted it to be a physical challenge for two ways, in two ways. One, because after I tore my ACL a few years ago, honestly, I just started to feel my age a little bit. And I was just like, you know, I don't have that much more time in my life to do a really serious physical thing. I mean, I'm not going to do this when I'm 50 years old, especially if I'm married and have a family. So I'm recently unattached. I'm still, I don't know if I'm in the prime of my physical career, but I still have like, I'm still within that window, right? There's still professional athletes who are 34 years old. It's not like that crazy. And then I also thought from an emotional point of view, it would be easiest for me to direct the energy and focus that I had in a physical way. Did it have to be violence based? I don't know. That's a deeper question. I don't think I'm going to get into in this podcast. I don't know what that means or what that says, but I think the fact that it was physical was important because I was able to get out of my own head, and I was in my head a lot as I was coming out of this like tough period. You know what I mean?
You pretty much just repeated your blog. It's the most impressive thing I've seen because you like had it in your mind. You said a word. I'm just like, God, how does he even remember all that stuff? Honestly, in that kind of order.
The reason for that is because the blog that I wrote was something that I had been thinking in my head for a while. Over like, I take, you know, I'll just like chill for a few minutes, and in my head, I'll like go through certain things that I'm thinking and how to phrase them and stuff. So I've had this conversation in my own head a bunch of times.
I guess a lot of follow-ups to that, what you just said right there. I think I want to go back to one thing. I remember you put the blog and I tweeted that. I can definitely relate to certain parts of it. I think that one thing you mentioned about discipline,
yeah,
being a poker player, you know, like when you said, when you don't want to do something, like you just don't do it. And I've certainly developed that habit very badly. And it's been something I've been working at for the past 6 or 7 months. And
how do you work at it?
It's tough. I think when I tell myself I'm going to do something, I try to actually do it instead of saying, like, I mean, it's very simple things, even like take the garbage out, put this here.
I
mean,
I agree.
It starts with these simple things.
Starts with little things.
Right. And then it develops into bigger things. And then it's like, oh, well, you have to go visit this your family member or something. You're like, I don't have to do it. I'm just not going to do it today. I'll do it next week. You keep putting things off. You put things off, you put things off. And I'm fighting with it, but it's certainly something I need to work on. And I think it's because with poker for me, and it's probably the same with yourself, is that, I mean, it's just like, it's really easy to do. You know what I mean? You sit down, you load up some games, start playing. Like you don't have to like tell yourself to go play poker. I mean, maybe some people do, but I never found myself having to do that. And with all these other things, I personally don't spend much time doing them. So you have to, it's like forcing yourself to do them. And like you said, you know, you don't have to do them.
Yeah.
And when you feel like you started doing this, do you feel like that has changed? Because
oh yeah. Yeah, it's much easier for me now to just like do shit. Let me ask you this, because I struggle with this too. Like, do you use poker as a way to procrastinate from other shit?
100%. Yes, I sit.
Yeah, me too.
100. When I'm at the computer, I'm like, all right, I'm supposed to be doing this, or I'm supposed to be doing this in my living room. I'll be like, let me just like go see if some games are running right now, and then I'm like, I'll just sit. You know, that's what I do. I've done that. Although I have say, I think that's made me a ton of money in the past couple of years by doing that too. But at the same time, it's helped me really, really build on those debatably bad habits. And
that's the problem. That's part of the problem that I've encountered with poker, is that you use it as a rationalization, you justify it, but the arguments are convincing, because it's like, I'm being productive. I'm working right now. You know what I mean? It's like,
right,
the more I play poker, the more money I'm going to make. So I can't really be wasting time if I'm playing poker. So it's like a way of convincing myself that I'm not wasting time, even though I'm also not doing the thing that I know I should be doing.
Right. I was just talking to someone about this today, and they were like, well, you're still being productive when you do that. And I was like, well, I guess that's true. But at the same time, I'm not being productive on these other things. So it's, how do you get your mind to, I know a lot of people have to experience the same exact thing and have no idea how to approach it or think about it too. So, but what do you think exactly it was that helped you, like that helped you start to maybe say, all right, if I'm going to do this, well, now I can start doing these other things I say I'm going to do that I know I don't have to do. Like what, like when did that, like, was it right away it started, or like, what do you think the.
Right away, I had to start going to training, and I was like, fuck. I was like, I have to wake up at a certain time. All of a sudden I had to do something in the morning doing something in the morning is real different from having to just do something. I had to, doing something in the morning meant I had to wake up at a certain time. The fact that I couldn't, or I had to minimize how tired I was, meant that I couldn't go to sleep at a certain time. So now I can't, you know, I can't do things at night that are going to like make it so that I'm going to go to sleep late. I have to try to focus on getting sleep. I have to wake up at a certain time. All my meals have become so much more regulated than they were before. I'm having meals at very specific times. I'm only allowed to eat certain things. Like, you know, and I'm the type of person, I like to eat all types of shit. I like candy. I like ice cream. I love pepperoni pizza. I love lasagna. Lasagna is the best thing in the world.
Shout out to lasagna.
Shout out to lasagna. So yeah, I mean, all of a sudden, a lot of shit was a lot of my shit was
regulated. Listen, three people will get that. It's fine. It's okay. It's fine.
That's perfect. That's the best number. It's the only number that matters. Yeah. So, you know, all of a sudden, all my shit was regulated, and I didn't really, and I just, the way I think I was in a position to view it in a specific way. I was like, I don't have a choice. This is not a choice. This is the way it has to be. So it, not having a choice kind of removed some of the shittiness of it. You know what I mean? I was
why didn't you have a choice in that at that point? Why didn't you have that? Why didn't you not have the choice before just because there's this publicized fight? I mean, maybe everything should be publicized for a lot of money. Then it sounds like that could be a solution for a lot of issues for people then.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, I think the motivation for me was more than just the publicity, more than just the fight, more than just the money. But all of those things are factors. I mean, who am I kidding? All of those things matter, obviously. I think it's a combination of those things. I think part of it is my own vanity. Part of it is my own ego. Part of it is like, you know, I also had this thing where I felt like within my relationship, within my marriage, that I had fundamentally misjudged some things. And I was concerned that this was like an issue that I had. So I was like, I tried to be as sober and as objective as possible when evaluating the factors that were going into this project. Cause I was like, I really don't want to be completely wrong about a bunch of shit. You know what I mean? Cause if I misjudge that and then I misjudge this, you know, it starts to become a situation where the common denominator is me. You know what I'm saying? So I really wanted to be on point where I was like, if I hit everything, if I check all the boxes, then the result is that the result that's naturally going to follow a super high probability of the time is the one that I want. So yeah, there was just a lot of shit going on for me that like led to me just feeling like, look, I'm a fighter for the next 6 months. This is what I'm doing. I mean, I played a bunch of poker too, but my mentality was just completely one of somebody who is dedicated to this project. I, for the first like 3 or 4 months, any second that I had free, I was watching fights. I was just like, I got Fight Pass, on the UFC Fight Pass, and I'm just like watching fights that go back. I watched from the first UFC, just watch like every fight, watch all the champions fight. Dan was like, yo, check out Carlos Condit. You're going to like him. I watched all of Condit's fights. He became my favorite fighter. Like, that's all I did was watch fights and think about training and like then try to train. I mean, that's what my life was like. I played a bunch of poker. I didn't do that well in poker, but I still had to play. And especially online, like if I went 6 months without playing online, who knows if I would even come back and still be a winner. I would have to take some real time to still be a winner. So I wanted to at least maintain some play. And then I also needed some breaks because, you know, my body was not conditioned or adjusted to this type of punishment. It's like, you know, your body gets tired and sore, you know, from workouts, but it also gets legitimately, literally beat up because people are hitting you, taking you to the ground, choking you, grabbing you. Like there's so many little fights within training. Like you don't realize like you're in the clinch with someone, and that's like when you're standing up body to body, and like there's like a mini fight over who has inside arm control. You know, you're on the ground with someone, and there's like a mini fight for, you know, who has head control or who has posture control. All these mini fights that go in within the fight, you're constantly struggling, and a big part of it is to actually learn energy conservation and to be efficient. But all that stuff took a ton of time. I would get tired super fast. And then when you get tired, that's when you can really get the shit kicked out of you. It's like when you're so tired, you just can't defend yourself. Your hands can't go up. You can't like get up. You can't hold somebody down. When somebody postures up to hit you, you're just like, fuck. All your reactions are so slow. You just can't do anything anymore. And so part of the training is just getting that super tired point later and later and later, you know, where you're just like, okay, I can survive for a few minutes now. I can survive for a few more minutes, you know?
A lot of stuff there again, Olivier. A lot of stuff there. I mean, I feel like honestly, everything you say, I have like 20 follow-ups. I just like keep clicking in my mind back. I wish I had like a real time spit out of my mind.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to cut you off your follow-ups.
Oh no, it's. I mean, I'm sure I'm enjoying what you're saying. I'm sure a lot of people out there are enjoying what you're saying. It's very some GTO stuff there, Poppy. It's some GTO stuff. So when you were playing poker, when you were coming up in poker, did you have it where you were basically 100% poker? Poker is what you thought about. You thought about 24 hours a day. You always thought about it 7 days a week. You just thought about how to get better, consumed it. Poker was basically your life.
I think I played like 90 to 100 hour weeks for like 3 years.
Right.
I mean, I used to go to sleep with my laptop in my bed and then wake up and then just log on. Before I did anything, I was just playing poker, and it was like the only thing that, I mean, this was to the detriment of relationships, to the detriment of health, to the detriment of literally every other thing that existed in my life was poker for a while. And that's part of the reason why my chat was fucked up, because I was fucked up. Like, I was fucked up. You know, I didn't have anything else. And the thing was, I could have had a lot of things. I grew up with tons of advantages. I had and have lots of friends. I've been good at lots of different things in my life. I've had balance throughout my entire life until I found poker, and it like consumed me. It like ate me alive. And there is a way in which I felt both very lucky and unlucky to have come out of poker successful. There, obviously, I wouldn't be who I am or where I am, lasagna, without if I hadn't found poker. But part of me was like, look, if you had failed at poker, then maybe you could have like put it to the side and like pursued a different life. And I'm sure a lot of people feel that way. It's like they get sucked into it, have enough skills, dedication, and intelligence to become successful, and that success becomes something that they almost regret, or they almost like are like, wait, what the fuck? What happened in the last 5 years of my life? You know?
I say that a little bit often now. I say the best and worst thing about me in this current day is that I can still win at poker, because if I couldn't win at poker, I could put all that work ethic, all that, you know, all this desire and passion to something else. But
and talent, like,
right. And yeah, but even just the mental focus, because the money you can make is just,
I mean, I just had this conversation literally today with one of my best friends in poker, who is a legit end boss in 1K Hypers. And he was just like, look, I'm really struggling with whether I should keep playing poker right now. And I told him, I was like, keep playing poker. I was like, you can make so much money right now, and that's not going to last. You know, apparently there's already a couple bots playing 1K Hypers and they're crushing. Like, you know, this is going to end, and it's going to end soon. So if you could still make real money, just ride it out, man. That was my advice to him. And him and I have had tons of conversations about personal development, about balance, about all this. We've, you know, since the beginning of time that I've known him, we've talked about this. But right now, if you can make money playing online poker, and he really can, it's just too valuable to give up, I think.
Yeah, I kind of mentioned that because I want to go back to something else you said, which was we talked about you put that many hours. So at that point in time, going into something like this, you already know the work ethic you're capable of. If you have the motivation, you know what you're capable of. You know you can put in those 80, 90 hours. You've done this before for years, so you know you can do it. I think that has to be an extremely, I mean, you can take that to sort of anything you do. And I mean, that's going to give you confidence in anything you do, because you know you have the work ethic in you.
I would say that poker didn't teach me that, though. I've always been like that.
Even before poker.
Yeah. And since I was a kid, I was like that. I've always been like that. I think, I mean, poker did I mean, I learned a lot about myself. I think what poker really did more than anything else was make me mentally strong. I think when I first started playing poker, I wasn't particularly mentally strong. And I think part of that was because I hadn't encountered a lot of difficulty. Everything, like things, a lot of things came pretty easily to me. School came very easily to me. Sports came easily to me. Even like social situations came easily to me. And I didn't really encounter a lot of struggle. And the truth is, when you don't encounter struggle, you don't develop real toughness. And then in poker, the strategic aspect of poker, especially in the beginning, also came easy to me. But what didn't come easy to me was variance, emotional discipline, mental toughness. I was a fucking crazy fish. And I used to like completely lose my shit. Over time, I just got better, got tougher. There was no, I mean, I sought out a therapist. I like tried meditation. I tried all different types of stuff, falling in love and having to put someone else's interest before mine, especially because I was a stepfather, was very helpful to just kind of like get out of my own self-centered bullshit. You know what I mean? Sometimes you need to be forced to be like, look, the rest of the world doesn't give a fuck about you and your little poker bullshit. And like, once you're able to take on that perspective, that like your self-centered universe of variance is just like not the be all end all, at least for me, it was like, it was eye opening, not really eye opening, but it was more just like a really good, helpful learning experience to just be able to move past my own petty bullshit. So all of those things together, I started to get like just much better at it. And now I think it's a real strength of mine, to be honest. But it was a struggle. It was a struggle for a long time.
Do you think you're better at controlling not only like the mental game, but your emotions in general in any, in pretty much a lot more situations?
In so many situations. Yeah. Like I just think poker players, I think we almost take for granted like how much disappointment, frustration and failure you necessarily have to go through. It's just like, it's just part of the experience of playing poker. And like, you know, people complain all the time about variance. Like variance is like the special sauce of poker, right? It's the thing that makes it profitable. Without variance, poker would be like chess, right? All the better player would win every time. No one would bet on it. There'd be no money to make. Right, variance is what makes it profitable. Variance is—it's like the thing that makes poker so special, even though it's also the thing that sucks the most. So yeah, I mean, you necessarily just have to—you know—what other thing, competitive thing or whatever, do you put like a ton of time and effort in? Can you make all of the correct decisions? Do everything right, and then not get the result? I mean, it does happen in life. That is a part of life. And I think that's why poker actually is good training. But in general, if you play tennis and you lose a match, you most of the time it's like, okay, what did my opponent do? How could I improve that stuff? Sometimes you play poker and you're like, I couldn't improve anything. I played perfectly. I just lost because that's how it happened. That's just what happens. Coming to accept that, learn to deal with it and move through it, develop the mental toughness to accept it. Those are all really important things that poker trains in people who play.
Yeah, I remember Ben86, Ben Tallarin on the podcast, he talked about feeling like a robot in a lot of his other daily just things he did because of playing so much high stakes poker. And when he said that to me, it's something like it clicked in my mind. I was like, well, fuck, I'm kind of like that too. And I was talking with somebody else today about this same exact thing. And I was like, I mean, I feel like it's kind of bad because in some spots I mean, I feel like I should have some sort of like maybe negative emotion, but I don't have a negative emotion. I'm just like, okay. Like, I mean, I don't know. I don't get really angry about anything. But then again, I don't get super excited or that super like happy feeling about small things either that I used to get happy about. And
how
I'm
are you
not
with
sure.
your girl?
What'd you say?
How are you with your girl?
Well, my ex-girl, shout out to Becca. She's not watching this anymore because she said she can't watch podcasts. It's recent, couple weeks
ago. I'm sorry to hear that.
A month ago. Yeah, it happens. But that's kind of how I was in a way. Like she was always say, you know, why don't you show like, yeah, I show a lot more feeling than you do. I show a lot more emotion than you do. I was like, I think that you do, but I'm not necessarily sure if that means that you just care more about these things or if that I mean, I feel like we control emotions and our feelings differently. And I think from poker, like it's, you play like 10 hours a day. You're trained. These times you should be feeling really good or feeling really happy. You don't feel happy. You just feel normal. Like you feel like, all right, I got to keep going. Like you don't really take the time to feel bad or feel sad or feel tilted. I mean, sometimes you feel tilted, but, and I feel like, you know, when I was with her, is what I would tell her is that I just feel that same way about everything pretty much now. Like that's just how I feel. And I'm not sure if that means I just don't give a fuck or if that means that I've just been able to control my emotions a lot. And it coincides with, you know, having sustained poker success, which that was my biggest leak back in the day when I used to play. And I still haven't figured that out. I'm not sure. I'm not really sure what it is, but that's sort of something I'm figuring out right now.
Yeah. I think that's definitely something a lot of people have expressed to me and struggle with. It's interesting because it's not something that I've really struggled with. I think I don't like get crazy about shit, but like I can still get really excited for stuff. And I still get like emotional about stuff. So I don't feel like a robot. I think maybe part of it has to do with an additional quality of compartmentalization, maybe. Maybe I'm good at compartmentalizing, so I can try to apply that in poker, but not in some other aspects. I don't really know, but I know that's a real thing. That's, I think, maybe not universal, but common.
Yeah, I think so too. I mean, I think a lot of these things we're discussing, we're talking about, a lot of people out there are gonna be shaking their head. They're gonna be like, yeah, fuck, man. I mean, are these guys in my head? Like, they feel like they're talking about what I'm thinking in my mind right now. So, you know, I feel like a lot of people out there go through these same things. They're on different levels and different degrees, you know, in different ways. And, yeah. You know, maybe someone picks something up, or maybe they hear something that they can relate to. They feel like, oh, they get an idea, they get something in their mind, and they're like, well, I'm gonna try thinking about it like that. And I guess we'll see. We had a lot of questions out there. We have a lot of comments out there. Why do his eyebrows seem so huge today, Mike? You got some eyebrow. I got the eyebrow. I mean, I like the big eyebrows, but
I'm constantly getting comments about my eyebrows. I've gotten some good ones. I've gotten a lot of made fun of. Someone actually made a Twitter account. I think it's called like Brows of Busquet or something like that. Like just dedicated. It's not, there aren't a lot of posts. I think there's one follower or two. But it's like dedicated to my big eyebrows. I'm also very expressive with them, which I don't do on purpose, but I've noticed in myself. I don't really know what to say.
I know that one moves and like this one moves. This one kind of stays. It's kind of weird. Let me go back to it. I mean, I've been looking at that too. I'm like, how the fuck's he do that? Like one, it's like the rock a little bit.
I'm not doing that on purpose.
It's a talent, kid. Hey man, you're a talented motherfucker, Olivier. Come on, you got to own it, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Actually, it's a question, Marion, you got two questions in on here, kid. I've asked three from the crowd. I mean, that's pretty good. How good is your memory? How many hands can you remember in a given session? How detailed is it? Memory? Well, is it memory the most important talent in poker?
I don't think memory is the most important talent. I think, maybe pattern recognition is, important. I think my memory is pretty good. I mean, my memory with hands is good. I think my memory, it depends. With numbers, it's very good. With faces and names, it's like semi-atrocious. My memory can be really good and really bad. Like, I, for example, I don't have a lot of memories from childhood. I don't have a lot of memories from when I was younger than 10 years old. And I know some people who have dope memories from that time. Part of it has to do with I don't have a lot of pictures or like home videos and stuff. And I think that helps people remember. But yeah, I mean, my memory is good at some things and bad at others.
Yeah, I've been noticing my memory lately is not getting very good. I mean, I remember any poker hand. Like I remember most of my poker hands I play today, but I don't remember some, like you said, names, faces. Like, I mean, I swear to God, I see some people again, I'm like, wait, who, what are you talking about? Like, who are he? Like, we met, I mean, it's just like, I don't know how, that's, I don't know if it's poker hands or if it's getting older or if it's like other things. I'm not sure. I need to figure this out because this is something that's getting a little bit worrisome in a way, because I'm just like, man, what's happening here in some of these spots?
I was reading a book on like how to be more organized and more efficient. And there's like little things you can do to help remember that type of stuff. You can like if you hear someone's name, you can like repeat it in your head right after you hear it. Some people like even take notes on people that they meet that they want to remember. There's like all these little things that you can do to try to help yourself remember. Cause it's, you know, we also live in a world of like just universal information overload, right? Where it's just like we're inundated with all of this shit. Most of it is useless or nonsense. And it's hard to sometimes remember things that we want to remember, but there are like little things you can do to try to be better.
I do both of those, by the way. I always repeat the person's name like multiple times in the conversation. Then I do take notes on people who I meet that are more memorable.
Like you're than ahead of the game.
Yeah. I mean, because traveling around for poker stuff, you meet so many people. I mean, especially with the podcast, I like to meet a lot of people and just, you know, talk to a lot of people. So I'm like, all right, let me like write these people out. Cause like I have this thing where I go on trips and I like tell people like, hey, I should have you on a podcast. Cause like, I want to have them on, but like, I end up telling a lot of people cause like you start drinking. I mean, you know how it is. I don't know if you go out at some of these stops or not, but you know,
I don't really, but
there's a certain number, a couple of people who all like, they go out every night and then you end up going out every night. You end up getting drunk. And like, things happen. You get drunk.
Things happen. Sure.
But you travel a lot now. Are you still playing? You have 6 months. You haven't been playing too much. I know you hopped online a bit, and I think you played a couple live events. But
I'm going to be playing more now for sure. And then there's the World Series, so I'm going to play all of that.
So play all the World Series.
I got a crazy message. You know, this is like, I wasn't sure if I was going to say something, but I think I should say something. And this is like breaking news on the podcast.
Hold on. Wait. What's it pertaining to? I want to take a guess.
It's pertaining to the fight.
Oh, it's going to be on Fox Sports 1.
No.
Oh. Bigger or smaller? I mean, that's kind of big. Never mind.
That's pretty big.
Is it going to be on a television station?
No, it's not about the fight. Okay, it's not exactly about the fight, but it's related to the fight.
Okay, tell me. I'm not going to be able to. A document.
I got a message from JC, and he said he congratulated me and said I fought a smart fight. And then he said, if you ever want to negotiate a rematch, let me know. And I was like, whoa. I was like, whoa. Uh-oh, that's intense.
Called up that, he rehired that doctor, it sounds like, huh? I'm kidding. For fuck's sake, guys. Come on. It's a joke. Man. I'm joking around. Come on. So what do you think? Are you thinking maybe a renegotiation here is in order or what?
So, I mean, my immediate thought was... Actually, I felt a little bit insulted, to be honest with you. But I felt like a couple things. One, I think we're still in the kind of emotionally residual period of the fight. So I don't think it makes a lot of sense to make any decisions right now. I'm gonna respond to him and say, maybe he's watching. I'm just gonna say, look, let's take a couple months, let this like blow over and let us like move on. And then if you still wanna talk about that, then we can do that or talk about it. And then obviously it depends like what he means by renegotiate. I'm assuming he's going to want to cut the weight difference down. He'll probably be like have some sort of insurance for steroids, which, you know, I'm happy to do since I didn't take anything, but he could do that. And then maybe, I don't know if he's going to ask me for odds. Like, I don't think I would like really give him odds at equal weight, but, or somewhat similar weight. But yeah, like if he still wants to do that, I will be interested, I guess. I mean, I felt pretty confident going in.
So you felt insulted because he said you fought a smart fight.
A little bit. I felt like it was a small attempt at kind of evaluating the situation from a self-serving point of view, one that helped, that served him and not me. Like, a smart fight implies like I was strategically superior, but maybe not physically superior or technically superior. And I felt like it was such a dominant performance or fight that I was better in every single aspect. I took basically no damage. The outcome was basically never in question. There was a half kind of leg lock attempt, heel hook, but like that, I don't think he really was ever that close. So yeah, I just felt, whatever, you know, I think everyone's entitled to their point of view. And part of the reason that betting is important is because it's the difference between people talking shit and people putting their money where their mouth is. And I think that's a really key difference because anybody and everybody talks shit.
The old jungle man. That's the jungle man's go-to line now playing in the GPL. He talks about people putting money where their mouth is and backing up their words with money. That's what he...
That seems a little silly. Like the GPL is, you know, it's an environment where people are going to talk shit because it's entertaining and it's funny. It's not because they think they're better than Jungle Man. Nobody thinks that they're better than Jungle Man, except maybe Doug, you know, like, and maybe his friends. But I mean, you know, I think Jungle just kind of didn't run that great and maybe overthought a couple spots. And then all of a sudden it's like, you know, it's like so stupid. I mean, that type of thing is like, you know, no one wants to play Jungle Man. Like, let's be real. I mean, come on.
We got a shout out on Twitter from Browser Busquet. Says, thanks for the shout out. Browser Busquet. Watching the pod. Hey, shout out to him. He's got...
What's up? What's up, bro? Thank you for the shout out.
The kid's got 6 tweets, and this has happened. He hasn't tweeted for over 2 years, looks like.
Yeah.
We brought him back out of retirement today.
What?
We brought him back out of retirement today. Perfect.
Sweet.
So the fight would... So, I mean, maybe... But I feel like in fights, most people always feel like... The loser always feels like... They did better than the winner thinks that. You know what I mean? Like every time you watch a fight, I mean, obviously there's sometimes where the guy's like, yeah, this guy fucked me up. But I feel like you see so many fights where the guy that loses is like, yeah, I didn't do this. Like I could have done this better. I could have done this better. Like it was pretty close, but I just needed to do this stuff better. And I would have won the fight.
I mean, yeah, I'm sure you're right. And I'm sure there's just a natural thing of winners overestimating and losers like underestimating. But I just think, I mean, you can watch, anybody can watch the fight. I mean, it's like, you know, I watched it like 10 times. I mean, it was very one-sided.
It might be, I mean, maybe for like prop bet GTO here would be to maybe say something else. I don't know. Like, yeah,
I'm
it was
not
like
trying
a real
to prop bet GTO. That's the thing. I'm not even trying to do that. I'm just like, I'm cool, man. I'm chill.
So fight could potentially happen. Now you guys are in the renegotiation part.
But that's aggressive. I don't know if I would go that far. I just got one message and I was a little surprised by it. And I, you know, wanted to break the news on Poppy's podcast.
Cool, man. Yeah, I mean, I hope to have JC. I don't know JC that, I mean, I guess I don't know much at all, but I want to get him on the podcast. So I feel like a lot of stuff, you know, I mean, the only thing JC's really been getting back from the poker community is a lot of respect and heart on Twitter from people.
Yeah, like, which is totally justified. I mean, he had like, anybody that gets in a cage deserves mad respect. He obviously trained real hard and probably gave up too much weight, and in the fight itself showed an enormous amount of heart. I think a lot of people would have given up way earlier. And not just heart, but like also just like chin. Like some people would have just been knocked out from some shots that he was just like, yeah, he just like fell back, but he was still good. I mean, that's cool. I mean, he's getting hit clean or relatively clean from a guy that's much bigger than him. It's, you know, it could definitely knock people out.
Yeah, I guess obviously you get one fight under your belt now too. I think I'm not sure if he had any like actual official fights before. I know he's been around the world, I think, for a bunch of years. He used to play professional soccer too. By the way, I was going to mention, because I don't know much about his story, but my buddy Ross and Terrence Chan, they put together this. They haven't put it together officially yet, but they record a lot of audio with you, with JC, with your guys, trainers, friends, family, everyone sort of related to the fight, and they're going to be putting out an audio documentary covering it all. I don't know exactly when it's going to go up. You can follow Terrence Chan on Twitter. You follow Olivier on Twitter or Facebook, wherever, I'm sure.
Well, the first episode is out.
The first episode is out right now. It's out right now.
Yeah, I listened to it already. It came out today, so you can check that out. I retweeted it. JC retweeted it. Terrence tweeted it. It's the first episode is out, and it talks, you know, it talks about, like, you know, some of the beginning stuff, some stuff that we've already talked about. But obviously, you know, JC talks about his point of view. It goes into like when he was growing up in Mexico, the kind of schools and areas that he's growing up with, some like childhood fights that he got into, what his fighting background was a little bit. It's cool. People should definitely check it out. And thank you to Terrence and Ross. I mean, they seems like it's going to be real cool, and they made a lot of effort and had the original idea. So I'm excited. It should be great.
Yeah. It's at all in or knockedout.com if you guys want to go check out part one of that. And for those that know Ross and Terrence co-host 2+2 PokerCast. Ross has been working with the PokerCast for a while. Terrence is also, he's done a couple professional mixed martial arts fights. He's been around the mixed martial arts scene for a long time, I believe, and also a poker player too. So I would definitely recommend that out there for all you guys. It'll be up in a couple parts. I'm not sure how many parts, but yeah, I'm excited to check out the first part. I didn't know it was officially out today. It felt like they had a lot of work. They recorded so much stuff. I mean, that's like a process on its own, putting all that all together and turning it into something. You know, you want to leave this in, you want to leave this out. You get so many hours and so much good content from people.
Yeah, I think the first interview we did was like maybe 3-4 weeks ago. So they had some time to like edit that part of it. So I think that's why the first episode came out like relatively soon after the fight. But like one thing about Terrence that's kind of interesting, I thought, was, you know, some people have said, I've seen them say like, you know, this was kind of obvious, this outcome.
I love that too. Before, before the fight, everyone's saying, oh, the weight's not gonna matter at all. JC's has this advantage. And after the fight, the weight, man, that was obvious, guys. I'm like, what the fuck are these people talking about, man? They're saying that the steroid experts are these same guys too, by the way. Yeah. He's got the fight experts as well, it looks like, but too.
Not just that, though. I mean, you take, like, Terrence, because he did this documentary, had access to me, to JC, and to our coaches. Like, he had as much more information than anybody, literally any other single person had. And then he went into both of our locker rooms before, you know, as we were warming up. And, like, JC looked good when he was warming up, man. I remember, like, there was only really one moment where I was like, oh, fuck. And that was right when I got in the cage. And JC like came up to me and did this like warm up thing where he like does this like punch combo and followed like finishing with a kick, and he looked smooth as fuck. And I was like, oh shit. I was like, it's too late now. But like, I literally, my head was like, fuck, man, this guy. I was thinking to myself, man, I did everything I needed to do. Like, hopefully I don't even have to do this part. Like, I can just skip to the end where I win, you know? And I looked at him and he did this shit, and I was like, man, this guy's gonna make me take this from him. You know, he's gonna like, he came to fight. And I mean, it didn't, you know, it played out well, but I had that one moment. And anyway, so Terrence comes in and he comes into my locker room and then hit JC's locker room. Then he comes out and he goes on Sarah Grant's Periscope. And he's like, I'm confident that I think that one of the fighters has like a real edge. And he was talking about JC, not me. And that's from the guy who had all of the information and himself is a pro MMA fighter. So there's no case to be made that this was an obvious outcome. Not to mention, if it was obvious, you know, you could have made a lot of money because the fucking line didn't really move. And there were a lot of people who were willing to bet on JC, especially at like even money, for example. And some people did think it was obvious, a very small group of people, mostly people who I'm very close to. And we all did make a lot of money.
So the professional fighter didn't think it was obvious, but the professional, the experts on social media, they thought it was obvious. Yeah, okay.
He actually did have a real opinion finally, and it was in the other direction.
Interesting. I don't know. I gotta get his official take on the steroid stuff now too, to know where to go. I don't know. Who do I try? Who do you go to now? The experts? I mean, you know, my buddy Vinny Vici posted on the forums. He said he showed me to a site called Natty or Juice on Reddit. Reddit, please don't go there, guys. You're spending too much fucking time on Reddit. Please do not use Reddit. Never used it. Don't log off now. Please don't click on there. But yeah, now then I spent a bunch. He like posted the photo over there, and like I'm like, so I spent like 35 minutes just looking at pictures of people. I'm like, oh, I don't know how you can tell from a photo. But I gotta tell you, those guys on there looked they're like four times the size of you, most of those guys. So I mean,
but the thing also is that like what people have to understand is that they've seen my body essentially in two situations. One is like during and after the fight in the interviews, and then one is the pictures from Twitter. So like in both of those situations, like I am pumped up to the gills, you know? That those pictures are obviously taken 5 minutes after like a hardcore upper body workout. I don't wake up in the morning and look like that. And then obviously after the fight, you know, there's a lot of blood pumping through my body. So I mean, I look bigger than, temporarily bigger than I will 30 minutes later, or like 30 minutes before, you know what I mean?
Yeah. You said there's a reason why you posted that photo on Twitter. What was the reason?
So the reason was like, I was trying to understand what his point of view was, why he was so confident and like what he was thinking. And I thought that he had created like a narrative for the situation that played into him having confidence. And I didn't think it was credible that the narrative would include me kind of not taking it seriously at all. I just didn't think that was like that was really believable. So I thought his narrative would be, and I tried to play into the narrative that I was taking it seriously, but that I was just over-focused on strength and conditioning at the expense of technique. So I wanted to be like, yo, look how jacked I am. I'm coming for you. Like this is it, you know? And just kind of play into that narrative of like, this guy thinks he can bench press his way into the fight, as opposed to like really learning technically what to do.
And do you think that the blog post you made previous to the fight had any sort of effect on his mental game mindset maybe going into it?
Maybe. I mean, I think it's pretty hard to read that and not think that this was more than just a fight bet to me, that this was something that really was meaningful and that therefore I really took it seriously. And then also, you know, I spend a decent amount of time thanking people that I trained with and my coaches. So I think it was pretty obvious that like my training was legit. And the kids I train with, man, they are both awesome people that are going to become like just my, like the people that I will always have a place for, and dope fighters. I mean, all like I booked my flight on Saturday home so I could watch my boy Christian fight. He was fighting for an amateur title. He just like armbarred this kid in like the first 2 minutes of the first round. I mean, we have already two amateur titles at the gym. And I mean, these guys are going to turn pro. They're so young and committed. I mean, they're going to be just like real deal guys.
You might, I think those are, they're 20 and 21. Was that their age?
So the twins, Christian and Brandon, are 20. I think Ross is 21 and Lewis is like 24 or something.
What are the younger ones' last names? So if we hear their names in the future, we can
Christian
know we heard them
and
first.
Brandon Medina. Medina, Medina. They're the Medina twins, and they're like known in the Bronx, you know, because they look alike, and they're like a bunch of badasses, and yeah, they're cool, and they're great, really great guys. So they really helped me a lot. So I think, you know, the thing was, I felt like I don't know what aspect of the situation, or maybe it was a combination of aspects that felt a little bit overwhelming or intimidating for him, but I felt like it was a little much for him. I think the biggest aspect was probably the weight. I really was a lot bigger than him and wasn't just, you know, 20 pounds. I think we came into the cage probably around 20 pound difference. But usually in that situation, you assume that the smaller guy has a better muscle to fat ratio. And in this case, I think the bigger guy did. So it was 20 pounds in actuality, but like the muscle mass difference was probably 25 or 30, which is a fucking big difference. So I think he understood that like, that was a lot, maybe too much. And I mean, it's just, you know, when the guy's bigger and stronger than you, you really, really have to have a big skill difference to overcome that, you know?
Maybe that's what he meant by when he said smart fight. He felt like you were using that weight advantage or using the things that he just couldn't make up for enough. And that's what you were focusing on. And that's what you.
Yeah.
Which would make, I mean, that would make sense. Seems like what you'd want to do in a one-on-one situation, right?
Yeah, and I mean, I didn't take it poorly in the sense that, like, I did think I fought a smart fight. Like, my goal was to fight a super, super high probability fight. You know, there were situations where in sparring, I might have gone for a submission or gone for something a little bit faster or fancier. But with him in this situation, I was like, I'm not going to give him an inch. I'm just going to try to lock him down and, like, come up and hit him a couple times and then lock him down. Come up and hit him and then lock him down. And in the beginning, when I tried that, when I started doing that, it felt like it was, he didn't have much recourse for that. And I was like, okay, I'm just going to wear this guy down this way and I'm not going to take any chances.
So what's next? Continue fighting, continue training. I mean, you get Poker World Series. It's hard to do much else when you're out in Vegas for.
Yeah. I mean, lots of lasagna, some poker, probably lots of poker. I think, for the majority of this time, I didn't think that I wanted to do that much more training, but recently I've just had this super strong urge to train, and even to fight. I just felt like there was so much pressure associated with training that now that that's gone, I can just kind of enjoy it. And I've met some people that I really like and really enjoy training with, and even fighting, like, you know, I'll either fight somebody from the gambling world for money or somebody outside of the gambling world not for money. But either way, I've already had my first fight. And so the anxiety that comes with that is gone. So I feel like those negative aspects to the experience will be gone. And that makes it much more appealing. So I don't know how long that'll last if I'll keep wanting to train. And I don't know if I'll really fight again. I have to also see if I continue to improve. I thought I made a lot of progress in 6 months, but it's still 6 months and I mean,
you're definitely going to improve. It's like, it seems hard not to.
No, but the question is the rate at which I improve. I mean, I agree I will improve, but it's like, you know, I don't know how talented I am for this particular thing. Like, for example, you know, the biggest part of my athletic ability is related to speed, and not hand speed and not quickness in my feet, but like running fast. And that is something that's not particularly relevant to MMA. Even the kids I train with, they're like young kids, smaller than me, in super, super great shape. But when we would run or sprint or anything, and we would do that like sometimes as part of our training, but not very often and like never outside, always in the gym, just like little sprints, I would always crush them. Like I'm very fast. I've always been very fast.
What were you in high school for running? What did you get? You got the.
I ran the 400, the 800, and the mile. But I broke my leg my sophomore year of high school, so I didn't compete sophomore, junior, or senior year. I developed shin splints after basketball season every year and didn't compete in track. My freshman year, I was a 14-year-old freshman. I ran a 430 mile, and like a 151 800. I was super fucking fast and won the New York State Championships. Like, I was really, really fast. So like I walked onto the Cornell middle distance team, which is a boss middle distance team. So like, I mean, that part I was good at, but there's a bunch of stuff in MMA that was just not naturally fit my, you know, physical skill set. One simple example is flexibility. I'm not particularly flexible, and jiu-jitsu, it really helps to be flexible. Also just like where my strength is. I mean, I can improve my lower body and lower back strength, obviously, but being able to like curl, you know, doesn't really help you in actually anything, but doesn't help you in fighting. And just like certain movements and stuff, you know, I never did any wrestling or anything like that when I was growing up. So all of it was just new to me. So I think I learned decently in the first 6 months, but who knows after a year or 2 years, whether my rate, you know, I'll kind of plateau or I'll continue to get much better. I don't know. We'll see.
My buddy Wiedemann's on Twitch said, tell Mr. Busquet his instinct to finish was there. That can't be trained. If he wanted to continue, he most definitely left out could, but I'm pretty sure he meant could. Flexibility is easy to improve. Yoga helps a tremendous amount. I've picked up yoga 1.5 years ago. I can do flexible things I never thought I could do now. So
awesome.
Yeah. It's, okay. But helps with basketball. You mentioned basketball too, so you play a lot of basketball. I didn't know you were a ball player.
Yeah, man. I love basketball. It was a big thing for me when I was 16, 17, 18. I was really into it. I tried to walk on to the Cornell basketball team, but there were like 15 6'1" white kids. We were all like kind of similar level. And they essentially created a junior varsity basketball team out of all the kids that tried to walk on. They had never had a team before. So I played on the junior varsity team for a couple years. And that was fun because it wasn't the commitment of a varsity sport. But, you know, I wasn't like the best player on the team. It was competitive, obviously. And then, yeah, I just always played pickup and stuff. And I love basketball.
How do you and Raptor Dave Benefield compare to each other? Because you guys got like a very similar. You're a little bigger than him, but you've got a very similar height, similar build, type of attitude. It seems like
David is he's a better athlete than me. I think I haven't played with David, with him in a while. He's really good, really tough, very athletic. I think he hadn't played as much basketball as I had, like, growing up.
Yeah,
so his like fundamental skills weren't I'm not like that great, but I think if he's continued to play, he's probably better than me now. But he's an animal.
<I'm playing here.
laughs> And he's the man. Like, he's the man.
Yeah, Raptor is the man. Like, yeah, you don't I think a lot of people remember there was a photo of Raptor posted on the forums back in the day when him and Dwan were living with each other, and they were, even before that, they were kind of nerding it up a lot, but certainly not a nerd. I mean,
no,
he's in some ways, but he's not a nerd in a lot of ways.
One of those guys, I think, where you just like, you don't really want to fuck with this guy. He's the kind of guy that like, if he really decided to do something, he would do it. If he had said he wanted to do the fight bet, I'm not sure I would have agreed with him.
I could see him doing something like that too. Let's do it. Why not? I could definitely see him.
And he would take it. He would take it like, I think, as seriously as I did. I mean, he's like that. That's my impression. I don't know him that well.
I'm hoping Jay Kuhn gets that shoulder healed a little bit. I'm ready to see that Jay Kuhn versus Olivier showdown, Poppy.
Somebody said something like that, and I responded being like, somebody was like, I wouldn't want to bet against Jason. And I was like, yeah, neither would I. In the way that I view it, I would never want to fight Jason because I actually really like him and because he's an animal. But the way I view it is like, it would be like a video game. And like, Jason is like the end guy. So like, I have like a bunch of people I would have to fight before I even got to him. I'm not going to like put the fucking cheat code in and then just like skip all the way up to him. That's stupid. That's how you get your ass kicked. I have no intention of fighting Jason Kuhn, okay? None. But I was just thinking like along those lines, like, yo, I got to fight like 3 or 4 more people before I even get to that status.
Let's think of the progression here. We start with JC. Let's say no rematch. Let's think of what it is to get up to Jake. I just remember we did the podcast together in LA. I just remember the force he hit his hand with when he was telling he told like 4 fight stories. The one he hit his hand so hard, I'm like, what the fuck? I'm like, we walked down the street to a bar. I felt safe. I gotta be honest. I felt good. You know, I normally feel good, but I felt extra good that night. I'm like,
you're like, just to make sure I normally feel good. You're like, I'm normally good.
Yeah, I'm normally.
But I felt better.
But you posted something like that in a blog, like feeling tougher, feeling more like a man when you walk around. No shots. We don't want to anger the feminists or anything like that. Yeah, you know, of course we want to preface it with saying that, but. Yeah, I was like, yeah, I mean, I can definitely understand that desire. I understand that feeling for sure of just wanting to be able to handle yourself or be more confident to be able you can handle yourself in a situation that you might get yourself into or find yourself.
There's a lot of dicks out there, you know?
For sure. I mean, you might find, maybe you're going to be hanging out there Rio. People are going to want to come after you and take their shot, man. Maybe this is their time to shine, right? Maybe not. Let me think of that ladder. Okay, so we got JC. Let's put a couple names up there. Who's that?
I don't want to throw out names. That's like how you start shit, you know?
Well, I'm just thinking. Maybe you're not going to say you're going to beat them. Obviously, you know, I can't even think of anything. I don't even know who's a fighter. Who comes? Mike Dentali? Seems like a kind of guy that likes to fight.
I feel like that guy would gas in pretty quickly.
I'm not saying. He's going to mess you on Twitter now or something. I don't know, man. Shout out to him.
Me and Mike are cool.
He seems like he's been getting himself into some hot side. I don't know much about him, but it seems like he's getting himself into some trouble lately.
I saw that.
On these poker forums and everything like that.
I saw that.
Talk some poker. What do you think? Poker? Want to talk a little poker here?
Do it.
You playing? Are you playing the? Are you playing the high roller event? The 300K?
No.
No. Why not? You don't play? Do you not play those events normally? Or
I've never played like a. Is there another word for it besides super high roller? Like a fucking crazy ass high roller? I've never played any of the crazy ass high rollers. I don't know. I just like you have to sell a lot, and I mean, I guess this. I actually didn't know about this one, the way it was set up. This one seems like it's set up correctly. They have this ratio of amateurs to pros. There's no rake. This one looks like if I could have redone it, I would have played this one. But I don't even know when it was announced and when it came up. I saw it after it was already done. I think I'm assuming it happened during the time that I was training. I don't even know. Maybe I'm wrong about that. But I saw it afterwards and was just like, oh, that sounds cool. I just don't even sweat those super high buy-in tournaments. It's just like a single tournament. It's like, whatever, man. You know, it is what it is. But yeah, I mean, I think this tournament looks pretty good. In general, like the 500K last year didn't look that great. I don't know.
Yeah, the advertised lineup was much different than the actual lineup, I got to say. And then this year, I mean, they did the same thing. I'll believe the lineup when I see the lineup is what they say it is.
Yeah, I don't know. But whatever. I mean, I'm sure Dan will just win and then it'll be a big party.
That's it. Easy game, right?
Yeah.
So poker, you're going to be playing, you mean Toronto right now. So what's the plan? Scoop? Are you traveling for somewhere else? And then World Series? Are you going to go to the series?
Traveling and then play some scoop. I might go to Rio with Danny. Danny's going to go see his girl and I might go to Rio and play scoop from there. and then World Series. And after the World Series, like, I don't know. That's, for me, that's like a cutoff point where I just like start to refigure shit out.
Are you going to be at the entire series going to be out there?
Yeah, I love the series. Like, I play all the small events. I just, my biggest issue when I play live tournaments is travel. You know, you do all this shit, you play a tournament or two, and then when it's over, it's just like, fuck, now I got to go home or what. I mean, it's just annoying. So being in one place where you can get your, you know, diet set, you can get your workouts grind in, you can play a tournament every single day. I personally love the 11 a.m. starts. So yeah, I mean, all that shit for me, I just love it. You just play tournament after tournament after tournament, you bust, it doesn't matter, you play the next day. So yeah, I like that. I love the World Series. And I've never had a good World Series until last year, but I love it.
Are you gonna stay up at Ara? Or are you staying, get a house?
No, I, for some reason, I preferred last couple of years, I stayed at the MGM Signature, which is very similar in format to Vidara. It's connected to a casino, but it's essentially like a small apartment in a hotel. I don't like Vidara as much, or like the Palm as much, just because those are poker player heavy places. And I...
Oh yeah, it's like down in that fucking lobby in the morning, it's like, yeah. It's... in the cafe, at the Starbucks, it's headquarters right there for sure.
So I like to have a little bit of distance. I don't like people all in my shit, you know.
Is MGM cheaper than Vidara?
I think it depends. There are different places. Like, you can get a place with a terrace. You can get a place that's like a one bedroom or a studio. I haven't directly compared. I think it's maybe a little bit cheaper because it's like not on the strip. So I would assume that it's a little bit cheaper, but I'm not sure. It's nice. It's not like a shithole at all.
Yeah. I think we're talking, I don't know if we talked about this on air, but my buddy Dave yesterday talked about the Meridian, a potential place to stay. If anyone is to stay at the Meridian, give me a shout out. Let me know what you think about it. But I heard there's a basketball court there, like you said.
Is it a basketball court place?
Yeah. And if there's an outdoor basketball court at the Meridian, or if indoor rather, I mean, it's like, seems like a very tempting thing, but.
UNLV is nice, man. It's cheap and it's not, are you going to rent a car? I always rent a car.
Well, last year I didn't rent a car at all because I pretty much just went. After I say Vidara, so I just walked to the Aria to play poker, and then I just, you know, cabbed it. Right now they have Uber, so I mean, it seems pretty easy. And I drank a lot. I mean, I went out like 17 straight days at one point in time. I just drank every single night. So I wasn't.
Oh, that's how you roll like that. That's
That was last year. So last year, all the Euro kids, like a lot of these guys aren't grinding every fucking day. So they're like, Joe Odson's like, Joe, do you want to go to the circle bar at Aria and get a drink? And then obviously that ends up with something. You know, that never ends up just at the circle bar at Aria. It never goes to dinner at the Wynn, and then it's somewhere else. It gets intense. And then I just let it ride. You know, a bunch of PLO, a lot of the PLO guys are there. So a lot of the PLO guys like are typically more fun. They like to do things. They're not grinding no limit holding tournaments. No shots at anyone that grinds no limit tournaments every day like you, Olivia. Of course.
Thank you.
These guys aren't grinding fucking tournaments every day. They like want to go do fun shit. So they give me a call. We go out and do some fun shit. And it sort of progresses and snowballs from there. And
I hear you.
And then you find, and then 18 days later, you're like, what the fuck am I doing with my life? I need to start playing some poker and, you know,
yeah.
try to reset your life. And
I hear you.
Oh, I'm excited. I don't know if I'm going to do it this year, but I probably, we'll see. We'll see about that.
I love the grind, man. I love it.
Are you going to play cash too, or are you just playing just the tournaments?
I think this year I'm going to play more cash, yeah. I played cash a few years ago. Last couple years I didn't play that much, but this year I think I'm going to play more, yeah.
Yeah. Are you playing, what's the main game you play for cash then?
10, 20, 25, 50 at the Aria. I haven't really played much at Bellagio, but everyone tells me I should be playing at Bellagio, so I guess I'll check Bellagio games out. I haven't really played much live cash in a while, so I don't even know if I'm any good. My impression is, like, I've always been like, poker is poker, and most people are terrible at it, so I'll be fine. But I guess people are getting better now, so I'm not sure. I'll have to kind of see.
I heard the Wynn open a new poker room too. Might be one of the places that might be some games too. Yeah. So I mean, if you got four places that potentially have high stakes NL games, Rio, with Rio, Aria, Bellagio, and maybe Wynn, could be more of a, you know, could be some softer competition because regular is going to be a little bit more spread out. So.
Yeah, but I mean, I will be playing a lot of tournaments. So I'll just be, if I bust earlier, there's some days off or whatever. There'll be that, but I do like me some no limit hold'em tournaments.
Why?
Why do I like them?
I mean, you're an Olympic guy. I can't figure out an answer to that question personally to liking those tournaments. But
probably because I've just run good in them. So I've had like a skewed experience of what they're like. But I mean, yeah, I just think they're fun. I mean, you know, I don't play PLO. So I don't, PLO might, I might, if I took some time to learn PLO, maybe I would fall in love with PLO and just play it.
Olivier, you never played it ever?
Yeah, I played it like a little bit, but not enough to know anything about it.
Oh man, an aggressive guy like you with that showed the finishing ability in that fight that you showed love the great game of PLO, my friend.
I don't doubt it. You know, my story is somewhat similar to Dan's. I know he explained it to you. It was just like we kind of missed the boat. And then my focus was always on trying to figure out what else I was going to do outside of poker, not like what else am I going to do within poker. So, yeah, I mean, there's a part of me that like has this what if with PLO, but I let bosses like you handle that.
I'm bad from the shadow. I live in America now. I play in the shadows right now, my friend. I live on the untracked American, untracked Euro sites here. So it's
all right.
You never know what's happening in those worlds, man. What's you mentioned something earlier. We kind of skipped over it. I got to go back to it. You mentioned this alleged bot situation at the 1K Hypers. I know bots have allegedly been stopped at PLO games. I also heard they're back at the PLO games. And if they're back at the mid-stakes PLO games, I'm 100% sure they're back at the micro-stakes games. If they're at the PLO games, I'm 100% sure they're at No Limit Hold'em Cash games.
Right.
But I didn't know they're at the Hyper Turbo games. What's
I think this is relatively new, and I just heard this, and I don't know any real details. What I heard was that essentially there are people who are playing and inputting, you know, like they're actual people who are doing it. They're just getting the answers from a program.
Oh, there was speculation on that before, right? Who was that guy?
I'm not sure.
I don't want to send a name. I don't want to call the wrong name out if that person wasn't involved in this, because I know a lot of people who watch this and they're not going to read 2+2 and fact check this. They're just going to think the name associated with that. But I heard that there was something going on. There's some sort of like actual dream machine type program that's what people were using and then just inputting those things.
Yeah, the people are going to find ways around it, I think. And especially hypers are just, you know, the low-hanging fruit, you know? They're the first things that are going to go because they're the easiest to solve. So, didn't surprise me.
Hmm.
But it's a harbinger? It's like, the canary in a coal mine. I mean, it's like the sign of things to come. It's not a good sign.
It's not a good sign. I mean, especially with the – even following the stars changes much, they just made some more – I mean, they just made like a very large amount of tournament changes, and I wish I was more up to date on exactly the tournament world online, because I know they've fucked with some things to make it just kind of ruin the ecosystem the past bunch of months, and now they did all these changes, and I'm just like, every change has to be bad, right? Like, there's nothing that can be positive for anyone in these changes except for PokerStars, so –
Yeah, it just seems like they have decided to just like eliminate the professional poker player.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that they want the distribution, you know, when somebody, the losing player deposits money, they want to get the lion's share of that money instead of a winning player get the lion's share of that money. So they want to focus on the games where the edges are the smallest, where variance is highest, and where people can, losing players, their money can last a long time. And like it goes back and forth, and every time the site takes a little bit until eventually the site takes the majority of it. And that's a shame in a lot of ways, obviously. I think, you know, my only hope is that, because I don't think there's a lot of hope for stars, but my only hope is that a competitor will start to emerge and compete. Because without a competitor, it's just, I think it's, I don't think there's too much good news in the future coming out.
Yeah, I just want to tell if anyone out there is playing micro stakes cash and you play on PokerStars, I'm writing something about this right now, but I got really into researching this. You want to go check out Micro Gaming Network. I think Betson is probably the GTO skin from doing research on what the best skin is. Their rake at micro stakes up to $0.50 is significantly lower than the rake on PokerStars, even taking into account rake back at the bronze and silver star limit. So I'll have something coming out that soon. But I was just researching this rake stuff at Micro. So I'm just like, it's crazy how much they fucking take from these hands. I mean, this is just, I want to look into the sit and go world. I want to look into the tournament, like just to try to better understand exactly like, you know, these differences on different sites and stuff like that. Now it seems like you're going to have to shop around a little bit. Yeah. And sort of
it's getting to that point where it's just like, you know, they've crushed their credibility. They've destroyed the goodwill that the community had, and the product itself is just starting to diminish in value and quality. And it's just going to get to a point where, especially if some competitor steps up in some small ways, there could be a large exodus. But I mean, it's tough. They're just so much bigger, have so much more money for marketing, and have such an inherent advantage, built-in advantage, because they have liquidity already, that it's tough. But yeah, man, online poker is it's getting tougher and tougher.
Why don't the bots, the we'll call them bots, why don't they play the 5Ks? Maybe they do play the 5Ks.
Because 5Ks are turbos, not hypers.
Oh, and so the they've only figured out the hypers situation.
I think, so much easier to figure out hyper stuff. You know, turbos, you're playing 50, 60, 75 big blinds. You know, if you can create a bot that's going to be jungle man at 75 big blinds, like, you know, you're probably already really good at poker, you know?
Yeah. What about for the spin and go stuff? Have you played any of those?
I played them like every once in a while for fun. I don't know anything about them. It seems it's like my guess is just like it's the kind of thing where when you play craps, you know, there's and I don't play craps, but I know how to play craps. You know, there's the pass line, the don't pass line. You can take numbers and put odds against them, and those are the more reasonable bets. And then there are all these bets in the middle where it's like hard eight, hard six, you know, all these stupid ass bets. And when you evaluate the different chances of winning, those weird, like random outlier bets are the ones that fuck you the most.
Right.
And spin and go seem to me the poker equivalent of those things. They're the things where like just screwing you the most. You know, they're like the oddity, the entertaining oddity that just fucks you.
Right. By the way, guys, you bet don't pass, play craps. That's a GTO bet to make.
What did you say?
Bet don't pass.
You bet the don't pass?
Yeah, you bet against a table technically, but I mean, from what I've learned, I think
I read this book where this guy made this argument of betting both the pass and the don't pass line at the same time.
I've thought about that one too, actually, but I haven't read anything about it though. But
his argument was you give up a small, like there's some small thing that you give up, like it's like, you know, because you win one with seven, lose one with seven, and then, you know, 2, 3, 12 or whatever it is, you win and lose, but there's one of them where you don't. So you give up a natural thing, but then you can essentially have the majority of your bets just be the odds, which are the actual true bets. So you end up giving up something, but you give up less than if you played any other way. And then his argument was you can make up for it by, if you place large enough bets, getting comps from the casino. He's like, you can get casino comps to override the edge that you're giving up and overall make a profit. That was his argument. It was like a really interesting book that I read. I was like, but he was like, and this is what he said. He's like, the biggest problem is that people fucking hate you at the actual table. Yeah. People get so annoyed that they make comments. Like the casino people get, like everyone gives you shit. And he's like, you have to be able to be willing to deal with the shit that you get from engaging in this ridiculous strategy. It was pretty funny though.
Speaking of betting both, I read some speculation that maybe that after that fight, JC might have bet both sides. I mean, that's what I was reading some comments.
Speculation. You read some like douchebag troll who like just said that for no reason, just to be an asshole. Like, I think it was Darren Rabinowitz, that fucking kid. Like, come on, man. That tweet. Like, I guess that's his shtick to be like that. Whatever, that's fine. But like, that is so disrespectful on so many levels. And it's like, this is like a real thing to both me and JC. And like, yeah, sure, trolling is trolling, whatever. But I mean, I just thought, you know, sometimes people just don't know when to just shut the fuck up, you know?
I read that. I was like, what the fuck? I don't think so. But he's going to get his ass kicked. I mean, maybe like he's some sick fucking GTO. Like, I don't know, but I, you know, certainly didn't seem like.
Let's just put it this way. There was a small part of me that was afraid that I was getting there was some level that he was on that I wasn't on. And I was just getting hustled hard.
Yeah.
And then the fight started, and I was like, phew. I was like, I'm not getting hustled hard here. Yeah.
Would you figure that out right away, like right when it started?
Honestly, I figured it out at the weigh-ins. Like, at the weigh-in, he looked mad shook. Like, he wouldn't even make real eye contact with me. He looked like he didn't want to be there. Honestly, like, my coach said to me, he was like, you know what it looked like? It looked like he thought he would never get to this point. That he thought you were going to back out at some point before this. And that he was here, and he realized that you were there, and that this was actually going to happen. But, you know, the truth is, I mean, it's a scary thing. Like, getting into a cage, especially with a guy who's bigger than you, like, you know, it's not, you know, it's, I don't blame anybody for being a little bit overwhelmed at their first fight. Like, I happen to be very well prepared, both mentally and, you know, technically, physically, but, you know, it is what it is, man. It's a unique experience.
I feel like you're kind of sending some shots during this podcast to his way a little bit, like low key.
Low key shots. Like, look, he fucking messaged me this morning and was like, or, you know, earlier today and was like, yo, let's do a rematch. And also, like, you know, I watched recently, you know, people can watch if you want. I watched an interview he did with Sarah Grant. Like, I had watched it before, but watching it now is pretty different. And it was at the very beginning when they talk about this fight. And I mean, you want to talk about like subtle shots. I mean, it's just like subtle shot after subtle shot after subtle shot, just like mocking and like making fun of me. Basically being like, I don't know what this dude is thinking. Like, he's an idiot. He's like, I'm just going to kick his ass. You know? So I just think at some point you just got to face the deal.
Hmm. I'm excited to see what happens here. You mentioned earlier about people talking shit, taking things too far. I didn't know this, but you got some contentious people that you have a spirited back and forth, it seems like, with some friends of mine, actually, some former podcast guests and podcast. Yeah, with Mr. Cunty Cakes, Jason Moe. You know, obviously he comes on the pod a lot. He sends a lot of shots at people. It seems like you two have some sort of spirited Ryan Fee too, right? I mean, what's up with that? What's up with you and the Empire and those guys?
The funny thing is, I don't even think it's with the Empire, because I'm cool with Doug and I'm cool with Jason. I'm cool with Donger. I'm cool with people, with Donger Kim.
Who's that? Donger Kim?
Oh, I didn't say his name right.
Big Dick Donger Kim?
Yeah.
Oh, I only know him by Big Dick. I don't know him by regular. I don't know people by their regular name sometimes.
I don't think I'll ever refer to anyone as Big Dick something. yeah, so like, I don't know what their deal is. I don't really care. But like, I'm not that surprised that, I mean, I rub some people the wrong way. I mean, I'm not one of those people that's like, like Phil Galfond, for example, even though somehow Jason has a problem with Phil. But like, you know, Phil is the kind of guy who seems to want to take everyone's point of view and just like kind of like make peace and friends with everyone and not offend anyone. And I'm just not like that. Like, I have real opinions and I express them. And I think it's good and important to call people out when they're being fucking dicks. So, you know, someone like Jason and Ryan, my impression of them is that they're like essentially like bullies sometimes. And that's not cool. I just, you know, I think that sucks. So, you know, sometimes they want to like direct their shit at me. You know, that's fine. Go for it. I don't, you know, it is what it is, but I'm not, you know, I don't see the need. And I don't think it's cool to just randomly just be dicks to people because you think it's funny or because you think it's cool or because it makes you feel better or whatever. But that's the way you get kicked with your boys. Like, that sucks. So I'm not really cool with that.
Do you have anyone else in the poker community? Have you had some I don't even know what to call them, like disagreements, I guess you can call them? Like, has there been anything else that anyone else that stands out that you've had something with?
I mean, I'm sure. Like in the beginning, when I was playing online poker, like I was a big dick. Like I was not cool in the chat. So, you know, there are some people like that. But I mean, that feels like, I don't know, like three lifetimes ago for me. I think there's definitely, you know, again, there's going to be people. First of all, I'm also expressed political points of view on Twitter and online, and that just gets people to explode.
I remember that now. You got into it with who was leading the charge on that? Mac Lance and Daniel and a couple other people.
Negreanu and I wouldn't say we agree on everything, but I mean in the situation with Matt, we're definitely in agreement. Matt was making arguments for Trump. And like, you know, I don't even really want to get into making arguments for and against Trump. I just think he's just so ridiculous. It's not even worth it. I didn't see the follow up to that. It was Matt trolling for a bet? I literally have absolutely no idea
what the hell.
I thought that Sean Deeb had said that he like lost a bet to Mac Lance, and I thought it was implied that he was trolling for Trump was the bet or was part of the bet. So I don't even know. And honestly, I don't give a fuck. Like the idea of trying to convince somebody on social media of a political viewpoint when they're very confident or set in their way is just, it's like, what a waste of energy. And yeah, I mean, I think politics is super important and incredibly interesting. And I wish every single person that I know that loves and is obsessed with sports could just take 10% of that obsession and knowledge and passion and just put it into politics. And I think our political environment would be 100 times better. But whatever, you know, that's some self-righteous high horseness, I guess, for me. But yeah, I mean, I try to talk a little bit about politics and then I try to post interesting articles that I read. But yeah, engaging in back and forth arguments is like, it's almost like something that, it's like seductive in this weird toxic way. And I have to like force myself to just be like, what's wrong with you? Stop doing this shit. But I'm much better at it now. I've gotten better over time. It's a work in progress, you know?
Have you gotten to any debates on Twitter with the end boss of Twitter debates in poker, Kate Hall, yet? Or has that not come yet? It'll come at some point. I don't know if it's come yet though.
I mean, I don't know Kate that well, but I think she's awesome. And very, very smart. Sometimes if she says something and I'm not sure that I understand or agree, like I'll just message her privately and try to get a sense for like what she means. And any time that's ever happened, she is always incredibly thoughtful and explains herself really well, which should surprise no one. And I rarely have come out like being like I don't even understand where she's coming from. Like I don't always agree with everything, but she's just, I think she's the type of person that's just she's so thoughtful and well-reasoned that it's just rare that she says or thinks anything that I think is absurd. I'm not a vegan, so I don't have the same level of ethics applied to eating that she does. But I've had conversations with people where I've felt like maybe, I don't know, where I wasn't really sure what I thought about that conversation. I'm not really sure where I stand. So I'm very, very hopeful for a time to come soon where we don't have to kill animals anymore. But I don't know what to think about that so much.
Yeah, me and Lafort were talking about that a bunch. The veganness, the potential vegan, the idea of killing animals, the idea that in 100 years we'll look back on it like we looked back on slavery 100 years ago and about killing animals and all types of things like that. But
I mean, that's a hardcore analogy. That's going pretty far, I think. And I also think 100 years is way too long. I think people underestimate how different our world will be very soon. 100 years, I mean, who knows?
Most people make it that far, right? I mean, I've been watching, reading a lot of stuff too. If you take some of these guys' word, they don't have like the highest prospects for the way the environment is and the way that the economy, I mean, the way everything is basically.
AI in particular, right?
Right. I mean, that's certainly a big one too.
Do you read Wait But Why?
Yeah, I read it. I read it after Igor told me about it on the pod last
Igor,
year.
What a boss Igor is, huh?
Yeah, Igor's the man for sure. Igor's the man. Yeah, he told me about the site. I was like, I'm gonna check it out. And I mean, there's like the one procrastination article that I've read a bunch, and I'm trying to like understand it.
That one's great.
Yeah, a lot of the stuff on there is very, very good. People are gonna say, what's the site? Wait, but why? Just Google it however you think you spell it, and it'll come up.
Igor's one of those guys, if he like tells you to read something, like you should probably read it.
That's what I figured, man. I was like, I mean, you know, he was gonna tell me, I'm gonna check it out at least. Like you know, he's got the GTO insight for sure. Do you hang out with anyone else? Like, who are your better poker friends that you hang out with or you talk with more often than other people?
Obviously Danny, this kid Alex Timmon that nobody knows. He doesn't play live poker. He plays online.
What's his name? I know. I recognize it. What's his screen name?
Lotta Lenya.
Oh, okay. Anyhow, yeah.
Yeah. I'm boys with Eugene. If I haven't seen Eugene in a while. And like I've kind of like gone, I've become friends with different people. Like I'm boys with Aaron. I like Timex a lot. I'm friends with different people in different groups, but I've never had this like click of people, like the Evil Empire or whatever. And I don't talk poker with pretty much anyone. I talk poker a little bit with Alex. I don't even really talk poker with Danny. Danny just is like in his own thing, you know, he does his own thing.
I can see that. Now I know exactly where I can see that for sure. He's in a discovery point of his life, man. I'm interested to like see what happens. Honestly, I'm interested to see where it goes. I think it'll be fun.
He's a guy that has, you know, a ton of potential. He could do a lot of different things. It's tough when you have a lot of options, and you're financially in a place where you're not pressured to do anything. Mm-hmm. I think it's, you know, it can be difficult to find not just motivation, but the right kind of motivation. And I think it's also, there's this psychological factor that I've personally encountered where you think, okay, every decision I make places me in a direction that somehow makes me further away from a bunch of other directions that potentially could have been better than that one. Mm-hmm. So that kind of hesitancy like paralyzes you from kind of taking any real steps in any real directions. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's like having too many decisions is a burden because you always have that what if factor. I mean, some people have it for dating or for, you know, women in general. You know, what if I do this? Well, then I don't do this. And instead of just embracing one or getting yourself to the point where you can just embrace one or two or even three things. I mean, it doesn't necessarily be one thing. People can't, and then they don't do anything for a prolonged period of time. And then they're like, fuck, well, why didn't I start doing this 7 months ago? And they never, it just, you know, it sort of goes on and on until finally they're like, all right, let me put my foot down. Let me stop. And let me get after something here.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's also, you know, with poker, it can be particularly hard because the poker lifestyle is so intoxicating. You just, the freedom, the autonomy, the money, it's hard to match, especially if you've like bossed poker hard, you know, like, and imagine Dan, like Danny's so young. He just crushed hypers. Like right when he like got into it, he just like took some time, beat everyone, got to the king of the hill and then was crushing it. Basically transitioned out of hypers at the exact moment that the profitability dramatically plunged, started playing live tournaments more and like won every single live tournament that, I mean, even more, like you were to envision your dream year, it wouldn't have even been as good as his year because you try to be like realistic about it.
Right.
And then you're just like, okay, now what the fuck do I do? You know? So yeah, I mean, it's, you know, he's in a unique spot for sure, but he'll figure it out.
Let's get some shout outs here, man. Ariel Benavide says, Olivier, you mean, would be awesome if you come visit your old college and give a talk to the poker club. Maybe next year we'd really appreciate it and love it. Shout out to Cornell. All right. I mean, hey, what is that a possibility?
Yeah, maybe. I didn't even know that there was one that existed. That could be cool.
I mean, apparently Ariel allegedly is a member of this club. So that
cool,
could
man.
Be
that's awesome.
All right, let me give a couple shout outs here, man. I haven't given a shout out for a while here. All right. Anyone that asks the same fucking question more than five times, I'm not giving you a shout out. I'm just not going to. I can't. Like, come on, guys. I see the questions. I mean, I can't get through them all. There's a lot of good questions in the chat. You know,
can I give a shout out to Lasagna one more time?
Give a shout out to Lasagna, Poppy.
Shout out to Lasagna.
What the fuck did this lasagna come from? What are you making lasagna? Are you a professional lasagna cooker or something like that? Like, what is this?
I'm aspiring to be.
You're an aspiring professional lasagna chef.
Yeah, aspiring. Wait, let's put it that way.
Do you cook your own food during all your meal? Because obviously you probably – no?
No, I mean, I do some basic stuff, but no, I mean, I'm not like – I can't really make many things. But basic stuff I can make.
Would you do, for chicken, would you get it, buy it at Whole Foods, put it in the oven, reheat it, or what?
Yeah, basically. Yeah, I mean, but a lot of times I was just ordering too. There's one place in particular where I can order and they essentially just – you can order stuff that they just put in plastic containers, steamed broccoli, plastic container. They had like bison meat, plastic container, like whole wheat pasta, plastic container. And it's just perfect. It's like, it's like specifically designed for people who are doing some sort of fitness, you know, watching their meals, watching the, exactly the things that go in, you know, there's no sauces, there's no any, everything is just plain the way that you like want it to, you know, without.
So you're like me, you're a professional oven user. I'm fucking badass at turning the oven on. Like I've got to be one of the best oven turnarounders of all time when it comes to making food for sure right now. So
yeah. And the food I was eating was just real basic. It's not fancy. It's not supposed to taste that great. It's just functional and, you know, supposed to make it look like I took steroids pretty much.
Yeah. I mean, with all the natural steroids, or natural testosterone stuff you got, you're putting out, plus all this stuff. I mean,
it's just like, it's over.
Yeah. All right. Some shout outs here. Let me see. Sledim one said, what's up, puppy? Can my girlfriend Jessica and I get a shout out? Winky face. Not sure if you're trying to make me like a cuck or something, but shout out to you guys, man. Much love. Let me see who else we got out there. Paul Peaches, puppy. We see a lot of regs out there, man. Alex T, my boy Marco all in. Paul Peaches. Blindside. Ekshesh Bakili, where are you from? Norway? Africa, puppy? Where are you from, kid? Seven Nocturne, Seven, Sir Chillington. Russ, what's up, Russ, puppy? Percy Control, Stoisi Iso. Shout out to Mustafa Kinnit. Yes, sir, that's what we are shouting out. Mustafa Kinnit, lasagna, puppy. Mr. Crunch asking the same question 15 times. Michael Cano, Mosa, Aladrish. Do you want to get some shout outs, Olivia? You got a couple people you want to get some shout outs to?
Nah, just lasagna, yo. That's all. That's all I want
to
shout out.
Do you know how to give a shout out? You like a proper GTO shout out?
I'm happy to learn.
Go ahead. Give one. Let me give you a name and you give him a shout out. My buddy Moose Skills.
Yo, Moose Skills, shout out to you, buddy. What's up?
Okay. That's good. We definitely can improve. Let's try one more.
Definitely can improve.
I mean, listen. I mean, first time hopping in, you know. Penos? Oh, fuck.
Oh, don't pick a name you can't even pronounce.
Zatayanis. Panos Zatayanis from Greece.
What is it?
Panos
Zatayanos. Shout out, Papi.
Okay, good. Is that better? Okay, good. I really want to know how to say this guy's name, honestly. It's Panos Xatzigiannis.
You got it.
Zatayanos, baby. Zatayanos. Do you have any Viper stories? People have been asking, they want Viper stories. I know you play with on Poker After Dark.
That's my only experience with Viper.
You don't have a degenerate Viper story where he came into the tournament room at the Bellagio 5 Diamond and put down $100,000 in chips on the table and something. I don't know. They've got some crazy Viper stories in the podcast.
I have no crazy. Literally, my only experience with Viper was playing on Poker After Dark. And honestly, he was really cool to me. He was like, yo, you played really well. You just ran really terrible. He was nice to me, man. I have nothing to report on that front, man.
Yeah, you got beat down on that. You got beat down on that one, right?
I did get beat down pretty hard.
You got the old full tilt poker RNG shuffle pulled on you there, huh? That full sponsored by Full Tilt Poker, right?
Yeah, that was brutal. I did get aces to ace king though, and that saves some money.
Have you played a lot of those televised cash games in the past?
No, I played one.
Just that one? Yeah, I feel like I didn't see you on the I didn't see you on the big game. I know there was a lot of like random guys who didn't get much shine on some other programs who got on that show on the Poker Stars big game. So
yeah.
I wasn't sure if you were on that one or not.
Nope. That was the only my only foray into live televised cash.
I noticed you've been you did the ESPN stuff. So you did the ESPN. Was it the? It was the live. It was the live stream of the days of the final day, final table, right?
So the when I first did it, we were doing it at like started at like day four, I think. So we did like day four, day five, day six. I don't think I ever did the final table because they had Antonio. Antonio was their A guy and I was the B guy. But there was a time where they were doing it for ESPN 3 online.
Yeah.
And that was when I was, that was like when it first started and got big and people were like, oh, having somebody that actually like really knows poker is like pretty cool. And then my big break was when Antonio made the final table of one drop because Antonio was the A guy and I was the B guy and the A guy was fucking at the table. So the B guy had to step up and do the commentary, which was like great. I mean, it was just a lot more exposure for me because it was on ESPN. It was a $1 million tournament. So, you know, a lot of people were watching. So that was dope. And then that led to Alpha 8 on the WPT.
I mean, you do a very good job at commentary, kids. I got to say, I feel like you're, you know, you got a lot of poker. You got a lot more poker experience maybe than some of the people that are doing commentary. You're very well spoken. I feel like you can put your thoughts together quite well. And probably I don't know how quick you have to be in that situation or if it's recorded beforehand. But I feel like
it's recorded beforehand.
Oh, okay. I would say if it's live, I mean, I feel like you'd probably do a really good job at just formulating very concise and quick thoughts on particular situations. So
I preferred live.
Yeah. Why is that?
I think for that reason. I mean, an edited show. I mean, I the thing that I loved about the edited show was the people I worked with. People at WPT were great. Ali is the man. So I like that aspect of it. But the edited show, I mean, you know, a big part of what they're editing out is the time in, you know, in hands. People are thinking, people are all that stuff. So that's the real time for analysis. When all that stuff is cut out, you have to really give kind of concise sound bites, essentially. So you can't really get into in depth what's going on. And that's what I like to do. And I like to do it on the fly. The truth is that we weren't actually at the tournaments. We're in a studio. We've already seen what's happening in every single hand. So we know the outcome. And, you know, you have this natural bias to, you know when you know the outcome, to predict it. And you have to try to fight against that bias, but you don't want to overdo it, you know, like right. Purposely wrong predictions or, you know what I mean? It's easier to just flow when it's live. You know, you're like, you can just get into the minds of the different players. I like to do it when, you know, the hands are shown only at the end of the hand. That makes it more fun too, because then you can speculate. And obviously it's good for the ego. If you're like, guess right, that's cool. But you know, the edited show was a lot of fun. It's just a different format from a live stream.
Yeah. One more quick shout out to Stacks the God. He said, give me a shout out after that 1K bluff I tried to pull on you the other day, LMAO. So this guy, Stacks the God, came into the chat. We were streaming some 5-10 PLO very late, like 1 a.m. And there was one table. It was a fun player. Guy in the chat sits down. It's a short table. He sits down with $250. I stack him like the second hand. I send him the showers. He rebuys $250. He doubles up two or three times for me. He runs up a stack to about 4K.
Wow.
Fun player is out of position against him. All of a sudden in the chat, he's like, I got to go to work. Or like, oh, yeah, okay. Fun player leaves.
Which guy said that?
The Stacks the God guy, the guy who sat down. So he made a lot of money. And he said, it's like, this is like, you know, a lot of my money I have online. Fun player leaves the table, comes back, sits on to the other side of him. So now he has direct position. All of a sudden, he didn't have to go to work no more. It was a little weird. But he stays there. I three bet him and immediately, we're pretty deep. We're like, I was 17. He's had 1,700 item covered. I three bet him. I three bet him with 2-6-6-8. You know, three
is
clubs.
Is that a normal three betting hand?
Well, I was in position. We're 170 big blinds deep, four-handed at the time before the fun player came back. I thought he was going to leave soon. I thought, you know, I'm trying to get some of my money back. And I flopped, obviously, a set on 10-6-2. And I ended up taking $700 of his money. And then soon after that, he didn't go to work for a couple more hours, it seemed like. And he left the table.
Right, when you lose a big pot, every other thing that you had to do just becomes much less important.
It's weird. You know, I feel like at work, they give you a schedule. A schedule didn't matter this time. But, you know, and all of a sudden, he ended up leaving a couple hours later. No money, nothing to show for it, except a story, a smile, and one ticket to Shower City, baby. So
shout out on the podcast.
And now he gets a shout out on the podcast, man. Stacks the God, much love, man. Much love. thanks for joining the party the other night. It was a good time. It was a fun time, man. That was yeah. Some of those Twitter. You've been I heard you've been doing the. I've watched some of the GPL stuff honestly, but I just, you know, I don't know. I can't.
What do you mean? What are you like lost? You lost enthusiasm already for GPL? What's up?
I was enthusiastic. I'm enthusiastic about it.
Bobby, tell me what's up.
Okay, I'm enthusiastic about it. Like people liking it, but like I can't like. It's like heads up sin goes. I mean, I'm
that's the best form of poker, man.
I know you're like fucking salivating over there. You're like heads up sin go fucking okay. Like let me watch this shit. Me, I'm like what the fuck. I'm play PLO 6 max. Like it's very hard for me to be like oh well he's got to go along with self. Guy calls with ace 10 versus oh 10. Oh like okay I can do it once, but like you know I don't know I can't do it every fucking day. It's just hard for me to do. So I've watched some of the Jungle Man stuff because this commentary is the most ridiculously funny thing I've ever seen in my entire life. But I heard you've been doing some pretty good commentary yourself during the matches.
I don't know about that. I mean, I don't feel super comfortable in that format, like on camera like that. I try to talk a little bit to engage with people, talk about what I'm thinking and stuff. But I mean, GPL's fun. Yeah, obviously it's fun for me in particular because it's a lot of – I'm playing a lot of heads-up sit and goes. But, I mean, I'm interested to see what the next phases are. When you're live, obviously, you know, Aaron Paul is going to be fun to be like playing with and have on the team. You know, I'm hoping that it's continues to do well, that people are interested in it. You know, I don't know. I'm going to do my part. I've run well in it so far. So that's been cool.
I want to read something you posted. Hold on a second. Let me pull that I posted. Yeah, I want to read it. Hold on a second. Maybe you got to fucking memorize in your mind. I don't. You honestly might. But let me go read because what you said was one of my biggest.
It was about GPL overhyping players and being careful not to lose its integrity.
Correct. Yeah, you basically said. I really liked what you wrote because I just wrote some thoughts in GPL before that, and you wrote something. I was like, oh, this is really good stuff. And let me just read it. Just because I want to read it. You said GPL has to be a little careful not to overhype itself or the players. The reality is that many top players are not involved in the first season, and we should acknowledge and be honest about that for the sake of credibility. Credibility is like respect or integrity, hard to earn / maintain, but easy to lose. Furthermore, I've already had a couple top players who didn't opt in express regret after seeing how fun it is. And additionally, we need to be able to distinguish between the true end bosses and the solid professionals. In tennis, when the 16 seed faces the 12 seed, it's fun and exciting in high-level tennis, but it's never confused for Roger Federer, Djokovic. Obviously, in poker, it's tougher to determine who Federer or Djokovic are, but we should still try to make these important distinctions. And this is in reference to a lot of the commentators on there building up these guys as like the best fucking players that ever existed in the entire poker world. And when in reality, that's not the case for a lot of the players that are playing in the GPL. And yeah, you want to expand a little bit on what you said in that post, though?
Well, yeah, I mean, I think, look, if it's tempting when the audience is not as like keyed in to the poker world to overplay the kind of skill level and abilities of the people that are involved and to just be like, these guys are the best in the world. And in a way it's true. It's just a question of like when you're, you know, how you're distinguishing best, right? If you're saying best by like top 1,000, top 500 people who play poker or whatever, then sure. But, you know, some people, and I think it's important to make the distinction of like, look, there are people like, you know, and just to like, you know, try to mend, you know, mend fences, like there are people like Jason Moe and Ryan Fees and Doug Polk who are not playing this. And these guys are like some of the very best people, right? I mean, and let's not like kid ourselves. Like there is a distinction between them and between me. There's a distinction between them and between some of the other players on GPL. Now there are guys like, I don't know, Jungle Man, right? Who is in GPL and is the man. Like there's no doubt about that. So we do have some people in GPL that are at the very elite level, but there are a number of people who are not. So I think it's important to just be like, look, there's a lot of really good players. We have a few like absurd players in the context of the way GPL is played, which is a heads up sit and go. then I am probably at like the elite level. But in general, it's just like you don't want to lose your, I mean, I don't know the better word for credibility. You don't want to have a situation where every single person is the very best, because then people start to like just not believe any of the things that you're saying, and they don't have a way of like distinguishing between or appreciating the guys who really have earned that end-ball status. So I mean, I just think, and I also know as a commentator that it's tough to do, because you know you have to balance so many different things, and that's why, you know, I spoke to Griffin about this, and I like Griffin's the man. Like he's doing everything he can. He's probably doing six different people's jobs at once. I think he's doing a great job. Both him and Sam are doing a really good job. I think they're hilarious. I think their insight is very, very good. But there is, it's a hard balancing act, because you, first of all, you have to appeal to a bunch of different people, right? You have to appeal to people like you and me who can make these distinctions already. You have to appeal to the average fan who can't make these distinctions and is just there to appreciate high level poker. You have to appeal to the people that you work for. I mean, you have to appeal to a lot of different, not necessarily, people with not necessarily all the same interest. And then there's also this question of tone that you take. So, you know, there's, you know, I had a conversation, you know, somebody messaged me, a professional player messaged me once about basically what he felt like my overall like deal was with him, my impression and the way I spoke about him. And he felt like I was pretty, I don't know what the word is, like belittling, like not nice about his own poker abilities. And my response to him was like, look, I'm sorry that you feel that way, but you were at a table with a few guys who are just really, really good. And I'm not disrespecting you. I think you're a good player, but I think it's important for showing respect to them and for being honest with the audience that there is a distinction to be made. You know what I mean? So I didn't mean that disrespectfully, but at the same time, it's like, you know, you have to try to, you want to be complimentary to people. You don't want to be a dick. But you also want to try to be honest at the same time. It's a hard balance. And I was just trying to bring some of these issues to light, not necessarily as like a, you guys aren't doing this well enough, you need to change and be better, but just, hey, let's bring up this topic so we can be aware of it and try to just be mindful during different ways of presenting players in the GPL. You know, I'm not in a position, and I don't want to be in a position to like tell anybody how to do their job or tell anybody how things should run. But I think we all, as members of the GPL, of the poker community who want to see the GPL succeed, we do have a responsibility to just like, you know, bring things up, be somewhat critical if we need to be, but just like, you know, try to all play our role and play our part to just make it as good as we can.
All right. I have to go to the bathroom because I'm drinking way too much water today. I'm going to give you one question and I'm going to have you, I'm going to go run to the bathroom. So I don't want to use the piss bottle on stream. Panos says, does Olivier think he can beat the AI? Claudico, go ahead.
Okay. This is gonna be a tough question for me to answer for a long time, cause I don't even know what that AI is. Is that the AI that played Doug and,
yes, that's the one, Poppy. That's okay. Go ahead. Give me like, you need like a minute and 1:15, 75 seconds of an answer.
Okay. My answer is pretty much no.
He's a very smart bot. Doug thought they had some leaks. They beat the bot. That's okay. I'll give you that. Go.
Okay. So I think like on my own, probably not. If I could like talk to Doug for a bit, then hopefully I could figure it out. But no, I mean, I think my impression was that the bot was very good, just not at that level. I mean, he was playing against people who were really good and particularly good at figuring out leaks and exploiting them. So, you know, I don't know. I didn't play against it. I wouldn't say that I would have a pretty good shot just because those very good players beat it. But if I could talk to Doug and he could explain to me what was up, then maybe I would have a shot. Poppy, come back, buddy. Struggling without you. Man, who goes to the bathroom during their own podcast? That's sick. How long have we been doing this? Oh, wow. Long time.
Wow.
You're back.
Wow.
How was that?
That was great. I felt great now. That was good. You ever you use a piss bottle a lot when you played online poker, Poppy?
Never once.
No.
Never one time.
Why not?
I don't know. I had a laptop. I could just unplug it and bring it to the bathroom.
That's true. You call me a nit? Wait, what did he say? He said I was a nit?
I said you were a nit?
I don't know.
No, I said who goes to the bathroom during their own podcast?
Dude, I go to the bathroom all the time during the podcast. I drink a lot of water. It's been 2 hours and 20 minutes. I gotta piss, man. Like, drink.
I know. I was just self-conscious because I was on camera by myself.
Look at this, man. I got this jug of water here. Like, constantly. It's full and I have to drink it all. And then I refill it and do it again.
I'm glad you're hydrated. I'm glad it's important.
You don't drink a lot of water in the regimen?
I just can hold it during a fucking interview.
The conversation. It's not a fucking interview, Poppy. Come on. It's a conversation.
My bad.
It's not. You're going to get interviewed soon. It's a conversation.
Man. My bad. No, during the conversation. You're right. I've been more interested in your answers, you know?
Why is that?
I don't know. I think you have a good point of view. I think you have an honest perspective on shit. And you talk about things that a lot of players probably think but don't necessarily like open up about. So I think it's cool. And you get people to do that. That's why I love your podcast, because you get people into conversations that they don't normally have and that speak to some of the unspoken things that go on.
That's the goal, man. Somehow that happened. I didn't anticipate that happened when I started doing the pod, but then it sort of...
But I think it's about you. I think it's a reflection of you, because people respect you and trust you, and then you just have this sense of talking about yourself in a way, and that makes people feel comfortable to talk about themselves.
Well, that's sort of like I forgot where I even read that. I think someone told me that after I just did it, sort of I did it because I thought it would just like it makes it more of a conversation. So when you interject your own experiences or your own feelings or your own thoughts on a situation, it's going to make someone else more inclined to open up. If you're like, hey, like, you know, you like drugs, they're going to be like, oh, no. But if you're like, yeah, like, you know, during this time I was doing a lot of drugs. Have you ever done drugs? And you tell them about your drug experience. You ever done drugs? Well, they're like, well, I mean, this guy just fucking told me about his time. He had it, you know, he was doing this or doing that. Like, I'm going to be they're like, what, you know what I mean? You feel more inclined to want to talk about it or want to get into it or want to discuss it.
Yeah. I think especially like but it's also especially the way you present it, you know, because some people, especially in public or on social media or whatever, they try to present everything in a way that kind of lacks vulnerability or weakness. Everything comes from a place of like, my life is great, or everything is good, or all positivity, or all this shit. And it's just like, once you open up that door to vulnerability and to like realness, then that makes it much easier for someone else to engage in that way too.
I remember one specific girl I dated. This one happens to be in the poker world. She always told me I wasn't very vulnerable though. And I think in relationship wise, I'm actually not very vulnerable in a lot of ways, but I am vulnerable when it comes to like talking. Like, as you said, a lot of people are presenting. I remember some tweets I made, like a lot of people on social media, especially on Twitter, as you become more big time in poker, you don't ever want to talk about struggles. You don't ever want to talk about failures. You don't want people to like, people are looking up at you. They're complimenting you. They're telling you you're the fucking man. You're the woman. Yeah. You don't want to be like, no, I'm not the man all the time. Like, no, I struggle with something. Like, now you're getting all this praise. You don't want to, you think like talking about that negativity is going to make people, you know, come at you a different type of way. When in reality, I mean, everyone struggles with a lot of these things. And I think people, you know, I think they relate to that so much more than the guy who's just like, look at me. I'm on the fucking jet today. Look at me playing a 25. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know. I mean, sure, people like wish they could be like that, but it's not the way that that person actually is. And I mean, I feel like they're given like this fake portrayal of people are going to try to meet these standards or meet these expectations that they could never meet because they're not real. And that person that they're trying to emulate isn't reaching them themselves. So that's, I went a little bit tangent there, but yeah.
That was good. I like that. That was good.
I'm not trying to get fired up in the podcast too much, but I got a little fired about that specific idea because that was something I used to do. You see these people, and you're like, man, they've just got to be perfect, right? Like, they've got to be doing this, doing that so well. And you get to know the people, and you know, they're struggling. They're struggling with the same kind of shit you struggle with and everyone else struggles with. So.
Yeah. And everyone's full of shit too. That's one thing I've learned.
Is that in any aspect of things or just poker?
Oh no, just in life.
in life. How do you think so?
I just think everyone is full of shit. Everyone struggles with the same things. Nobody really knows anything. Very few people know like a very, very limited things. You know, like there's some people who actually know something, and that something is usually very narrow. But most people just don't really know anything. And when people pretend to know things, you know, that I think that's where they really get into trouble. There's this quote, right, where it's like, it's not the thing that you don't know that's the most dangerous. It's the thing that you do know that's just not true. I think just ain't true is the actual quote. I forget who said it. But yeah, I mean, overconfidence and lack of self-awareness is just so omnipresent. It's prevalent in every field and every aspect. And it's like super important, I think, for people to try to keep that type of perspective, to just like chill the fuck out, you know? Nobody knows anything really.
What do you think you know? If the one or two things, if those two things exist, what do you think you know?
I think I know enough to know that I don't know anything. Like I know enough. And I think actually one thing I do know is I have a sense for a process to figure something out. Like, and that's what I was trying to apply to the fight. I had a sense for like, if I have a goal, I'm pretty sure I can figure out a way to get pretty close to or get to that goal. And, you know, there's some personal qualities that are involved. It has to do with finding people who are both invested in your success, who have the right kind of expertise to share with you to expedite your learning process. Like, just being able to, like, surround yourself with people who can help you succeed. That's one thing I think I do have a sense for. Is I don't know in which direction I want to need to apply that or where I'm going to apply that, but I think that's one thing I know. And I know like how to play heads up sitting goes, kind of.
Yeah, when I think about that question, like I remember my one ex-girlfriend, she always just talking about like science and like rocks and all this stuff. And she was always like, I never know what to say. Cause I'm not going to like, I don't want to fake. Like I know any, like, I literally know nothing about the stuff she's talking to me about. And I'm just like listening. She's like, you never talk about it. I'm like, I like listening to what you're saying. I'm trying to learn because I don't know anything. I mean, I guess in that sense you could say, then I should maybe go take an effort to go online and study YouTube videos or like read some fucking books or something like that and learn. But then something I do on the podcast, I just like listening to a lot of things people talk about. And sometimes I might not say as much because like, I don't really necessarily have much to add. Like I'm not going to fake, like I can add something to a point or a thought that someone says when I can't. So I just like to listen. I take things in, and I think listening is a very underrated thing that a lot of people just, I don't know. They like, they're not really listening. I know before I never used to listen.
They're waiting their turn, right?
Yeah, when I played poker, I mean, I'm just like someone's talking, like I'm just thinking about poker. I'm not like thinking, I don't give a fuck what they say. I just didn't count like poker, man. Are you talking poker? You want to go play PO? You need a 24? You want to play PLO? What do you want to do? You want to talk a PLO hand? And they're like, but they don't play poker. So it was a very large disconnect for me and anyone that wasn't a poker player for 5 or 6 years there.
I think there's actually one more thing that I do know. It might get a little awkward. Okay. I think I know how to love someone too. That is one thing that I've learned.
Oh, okay. Go ahead. I don't listen. I don't mean, are you talking like loving? Like I'm going to lay you on the bed. I'm going to show you my moves? Or?
No. I'm not. I mean, yeah, whatever. But that's not what I meant.
Okay.
No, I just know how to like, that's one thing I've learned over the last few years is just how to really be there for someone. So hopefully I can find someone to do that with.
Hmm. Sound like Justin Bieber now, man. I just need somebody to love.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Sounds like your concert you got to go to, man. I'm learning about this whole idea of loving someone else. What it even means. You know, what does it mean, man? I'm not sure. What does it mean if you love somebody, like, so then you put them before you, or then you care about them more than you care about yourself, or and then it's like, how do you get yourself to care about, how do you get to do that? Because that's something I'm not very good at.
Get yourself there? Why don't you think it just happens naturally?
You think it happens naturally?
I think it can, yeah. I mean, yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think you have to probably, I don't know, be open in some ways and like be willing in some ways.
But. Yeah, that's probably it. Yeah, be willing to sacrifice certain things that you may have worked for, or you may have put yourself in a position to have or to do.
And but I think, like, the way I look at it is, it's just about, like, understanding. I think it's about understanding self-interest, and it's about understanding the difference between short-term and, like, long-term, or, like, shallow and profound self-interest. Like, when you love someone and you put them, like, genuinely before you, like, you end up benefiting more. You end up, like, it's a better situation for you. It's not, you know, it's not like, you know, it's like this idea that being selfish and thinking about yourself is like ends up benefiting you at the expense of others. I don't even think that's true. I think if you genuinely give, then you end up better off yourself. So it's like a self-interested argument for, like, loving. And I think that's much more convincing than any other argument.
You're hitting on a lot of topics that I was talking with somebody about today.
Oh, yeah?
Which is like the idea is that...
You seem to have a lot of dope conversations with people.
I mean, one particular person I had a first talk with today. And I'll tell you more about it after the podcast, actually. But yeah, it was we were talking about the idea of, like, whatever it is you do, it's not a... I mean, this is going to get... I mean, whatever. We probably talk fuck poker after this. But people out there, you know, I mean, this is the kind of stuff...
It was my fault that the conversation went this way. I'm sorry.
You know, this is the kind of stuff I talk about this more than I talk about poker. I mean, this is, like, the kind of thing I'm thinking about a lot more lately. It's just, like, whatever it is you choose to do is, like, the right thing, you know? And it's like, if you're not... You know, if you embrace your decision, whatever it is, if you embrace your decision and put someone else before you, it's going to be a good decision. It'll be the right decision. And whereas if you're having this sort of regret, or you're thinking I should be doing this, or I should be doing that, or you're thinking about what you're missing out on, that's sort of going to make it negative right there, because you have the wrong mindset for it going into it. And
yeah. If
you can get yourself to not have that mindset, then putting someone else before you or not putting someone else before you, either one is going to be great, because you're going to make the best of the situation that you're in.
This person sounds cool.
I would agree. You probably know her, actually. I think you probably know her. Yeah, I would imagine you do. I don't know. We'll see. Maybe we'll get on the podcast sometime. Do you read books? Are you a book reader? I got to ask this question about books.
Yeah, I haven't read nearly as many books in the last year. Yeah, it's been a tough year. Before that, I was reading lots of books, a lot of audiobooks and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Do you take notes when you read audiobooks, or do you remember? Like, how do you? Because I have to take notes constantly when I listen podcasts or I read books. I take a lot of notes.
I think that's good. I probably should, and I think that's dope that you do that. That's impressive. My hat's off to you. I don't. I actually sometimes re-listen to audiobooks, but I don't really take notes.
They're so long though, but like they're like long. Or really, most audiobooks. I mean, if you like a standard book into audio, it's a couple hours, 4 or 5, 6 hours sometimes.
Or more. Yeah, some of the books I'm reading are more. Yeah, I do a lot of walking in Toronto and New York City. I'm just doing a lot of walking when I'm driving, even sometimes when I'm playing poker. Sometimes like I'm listening in a way that's, you know, I'm kind of doing something else, but it's listening, but I'm still listening. Mm-hmm. So it's important for me sometimes to just re-listen to stuff. I can't wait for there to be a better process to like get information than like looking at words and trying to get them into your brain or listening to them. And, you know, I mean, it seems so inefficient, like incredibly inefficient. I'm waiting for the matrix time where they can just like upload shit into your brain.
I was going to say, what could it be? That sounds a little unreal. I mean, I don't know. They got all kind of crazy stuff they're working on. I mean, I guess.
I don't know, man, but I need an upgrade. My brain needs an upgrade.
Yeah. You think, I mean, that could happen, right? AI, I don't know how much you study AI. It could, something, you never know.
Fake. I study AI the way like a casual person studies anything. Yeah, like, I don't know anything, but I have some ideas that are probably wrong.
All right, cool. A couple people are giving a couple questions a lot. Hold on, let me go back to this one SEO Quest was talking about. He said, I feel like a douche because I keep asking this, Joey, but ask Olivier about Monkey Flush. They battle each other almost every day. They've been playing one of the biggest heads-up single grud matches ever. Thousands of games.
I mean, I don't really know what to say. Like, I wouldn't consider a grudge match. Maybe the kid has a grudge against me. Just like the community of people who play Turbo Heads Up Sit and Goes is pretty small. So you're going to end up playing the same person. Him and I, like, doesn't seem like there's a huge edge there, but we just keep playing. I mean, I'm sure he thinks there's a small edge, and I know I think there's a small edge. So you just keep playing the same people. But I don't see it as a grudge. I think the guy's really good. I've heard he's like a nice kid. I have nothing against him at all.
Shout out to him, man. Shout out to him.
Shout out to Monkey Flush.
Jonas said he was never – someone asked, did he ever go busto? And then Jonas said he was never bust. He had Upper East Side penthouse starting out, big smiley face.
Was not a penthouse, but yeah, I grew up very advantaged.
Were you in that show? What was that show called? Gossip Girl. You in Gossip Girl? Is that no. About you? Chuck Bass? Is Chuck Bass you? Is that?
No, I don't know that show, but I'm pretty sure the answer is still no. No, I mean, my parents are super, super hardworking, successful people, but like, you know, humble and never like flashy with money or anything. Just like, always focused on hard work and education. And I grew up in Manhattan going to private schools. Like, you know, that's a very specific kind of life.
I feel like people hold that against you or something as some sort of,
you
didn't
know
what you got, or you didn't work for what you had because you grew up in this situation?
I don't know. I mean, it's weird because in poker, you know, I basically taught myself how to play poker and built a bankroll. I mean, I had a job that paid some money, and maybe I got that job through a series of advantages that I had. But, through poker was not like – wasn't like a friend of my mom who, like, got me my poker job. You know what I mean? It wasn't like that.
What was your job?
I was working at a hedge fund in essentially a middle-to-back office capacity, supporting traders, reconciling accounts – just taking care of the back end shit that they needed. I always aspired to like learn how to trade and to trade, but the hedge fund that I was working at didn't have a lot of internal promotion from middle office to front office, from non-revenue generating to revenue generating. And I found poker pretty quickly and was just like all about the poker world. Like I remember I was such a big fanboy of Spirit Rock.
I also had him on the pod. He said he wanted to come on the pod, and we haven't like officially set it up, man. He's so sick, man. He's such a legend.
There's a way in which he was the first step that led me to getting fired, because the first time I ever downloaded a poker website onto a work computer was not to play. It was just to watch him play. I was like on the 2+2 forums, and you know, like when it happens, when like some boss is going to play or some matchup's going to play, you know, it's kind of like, so, you know, somebody rushes 2+2 and they're like, yo, Spirit Rock is on like 50, 100, like let's go. And I was just like, holy shit, I'm not going to be home for 2 hours. I'm probably going to miss this. Like, this is the most important thing that's happened all week, Spirit Rock. And I was like, fuck that. So I was like, it was late at night. I remember it was like 7:30, 8 o'clock at night. And I was looking around, there was like no one there, or very few people there. And I'm like, yo, let me get Full Tilt Poker on this computer. I don't even know if it was going to, like, you know, if the, you know, at a bank or something, they would have been like, this website is blocked. You cannot download this. But I was at a hedge fund with much looser types of restrictions. So Full Tilt Poker, I download, and it just like pops up. And I'm like looking around, I'm going to the thing, and I'm like, there's Spirit Rock, and he's playing. And I'm like watching. And I remember somebody actually passed by my desk, and they were like, oh, what are you doing? And I was like, don't worry, I'm not playing. I'm just watching. I'm just watching this guy play. And they gave me this like really weird look, and then they walked away. And I was like, it's 8 o'clock at night, you know, fuck you. But that was the first step. That was the way that the first, first time I ever downloaded a poker site onto a work computer was to watch Spirit Rock play.
So you might say that he got you into poker. I mean, he kind of got you into online poker, it sounds like.
Well, I was already playing. I was already playing all the time.
Oh, okay. No, you saw
just saying, at work. I'm just saying at work. I was playing at home. I would like, okay. You know, yeah, I was super into 2+2. I was like reading all this 2+2 stuff, the high stakes, no limit forums, and playing when I got home. I don't know what's, I think I was playing like, there was no 3-6, maybe 5-10 at the time. But Spirit Rock was the end boss, you know?
Rysak said, when was the Spirit Rock hype? LOL, what the fuck, never heard of. I gotta tell you, kid, you missed a long year's run over many sites, many ups and downs, scams, and.
Oh yeah, man! Oh, he crushed it for so long. I mean, this was probably 2006 or 2007.
Wasn't he playing on UB? Like, was he playing UB before that? Like, he was playing with the super. He was getting used. The guy getting super used.
Yes, I don't remember. I mean, I remember him playing on UB. I thought he was playing on Full Tilt at the same time, but I'm not sure.
Mm.
This was when Brian Townsend was still playing like 5'10". He hadn't
even before that point.
Yeah, because I remember him and I came up kind of together, except he was better than me, and then he just. Like, we got up to 25-50, and then I won some and then lost a bunch, and he just kept winning and then just, boom, crushed it.
Yeah, and talent. I don't know what happened to Brian. I think he's doing a lot of athletic-type stuff, I believe. Running stuff.
An MMA fighter?
No, I think he's doing a lot of – I think he was doing running stuff before.
Oh, that's cool.
Like marathon-type stuff, maybe? I can't remember exactly what.
Marathon stuff?
I'm not sure if it was that or if it was more something a little more intense. I can't remember what it was. Yeah. Yeah, I think he was living in Canada, Vancouver, somewhere in Vancouver, maybe something like that. I can't remember. It was a couple years ago. Joey, are you going to ask him the online poker masturbating question? Sure. Do you ever tried masturbating while playing poker on sites at the same time? We talk about this. This is our new favorite question we ask everybody.
No.
Why not?
Why not?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know.
Oh, I mean, I just do it all the time. I gotta tell you guys, I've been in the lab. I've been working for you guys in the podcast world. I've been in the lab trying to study the effects of masturbation while playing poker in 2016 as well. And I got a GTO report coming out as soon as I accumulate enough sample size results for that. But I gotta tell you, it's a great way to just detilt, man. That's what I said back in the day. I 24 tails.
Why you stop playing poker for a fucking 5 minutes then?
I was 24 tailing PLO Poppy when I was.
That might be a difference because I'm a one table grinder, man.
Yeah. And I got to tell you, the answer didn't sound very reassuring as well. Yeah, a couple people in the chat pointed that out. You didn't sound like. Think about this. When we talked about the steroids, think about, babe. So, one, you think about your tone during that, right? Ask you the masturbation question. Think about your tone during. Yeah, maybe a tell.
I'm not a tell. No, I have never done that while playing online poker, and I never really occurred to me to do it either.
Oh, yeah, no. Yeah.
I'm usually fucking yelling at the screen when I'm playing.
That's what I'm saying. This will help.
I'm not trying to get excited at all.
Try it during a GPL match, maybe.
I'm on camera during the GPL match anyway, you weirdo.
No, not the cam one. That's weird. No, not the fucking
cam. Yeah, that would be weird. No, because without the cam, it's perfectly normal.
Can't wait for the report, Poppy. Guys, don't worry. I'll have the report coming out right for you guys very soon, my friend. Right for you very soon. Okay, Akeshe Bekeleli asked this question a bunch of times. Ask him about philosophical influences. We're a couple hours in the podcast. Listen, I can ask that fucking question and say that answer now. Only a couple people are hearing it, so...
Okay.
The retention rate over 20,000 plus viewers is going to be about 27% this long in the podcast. So 27% of those people are going to fucking hear that. That's okay. I've said it before a couple times, and I got no shame about it. That's fine. Trying to turn us into chatterbait.
Philosophical influences. My favorite philosopher was probably Soren Kierkegaard. I was a whole fanboy of existentialists for a while. But I, you know, when I was in college, that was a long time ago, and I didn't really, I don't know. I don't think I took school as seriously as I should have. I was kind of an idiot when I was for a while. So I probably, even though I majored in philosophy, there's probably a bunch of people who majored in philosophy who have much more set views about specific whatever. I don't know. The reason that I first got interested in it was because it was just like one of the first times that I really thought seriously about certain questions that philosophy tries to answer. Questions about ethics, questions about what type of state what a state should look like, what a person should look like, and how, what the rationales were for acting in certain ways and behaving and treating people in certain ways. And I just found that to be like really interesting and just more practical and valuable than learning something that I was going to use in a job. I was like, I'm not nearly as concerned with like treating college as a way to prepare for a professional life as I am to like prepare for my overall life. That's how I view it.
This guy, Soren Kierkegaard, looks exactly like you'd expect a PLO boss to look.
Oh, really?
Literally looks exactly how you would expect like a fucking Barry, like, I mean, not Barry Switz, I know him, like Futek to look. Just looks just like you'd picture Futek, the one of like the best PLO players right now. This guy, literally, Denmark, just looks, born in 1813, died in 1855. His hair looks extremely GTO. I mean, I didn't even know you could possibly make your hair look this way back in the day. So, guy's playing great for sure. Let me pull this picture up. Hold on a second. Let me see if I can get this picture up here. All right, hold on, let me make sure. Let me see if I can do this here. Make sure I'm no porn open or anything like that. Screen two? No, I don't want to do screen two. All right, here you go. Share. All right. Look at this guy. Tell me this guy does not look like you'd expect a PLO player to look right now in 2016. Like, seriously, looks just like a PLO player. All right. No one else can see the picture, but it's okay. That's it. All right, guys. I'm going to take some more questions if anybody else has them in the chat. I've literally never looked at anything philosophical in my life, so I haven't. I know. Yeah, I haven't. Yeah, I haven't even thought about it. I haven't even considered it.
You have that natural inclination.
I don't know, man. I guess I blame drugs or something. I'm not sure where it came from, but I don't. Yeah, I don't know. What?
You do a lot of drugs?
Not anymore. I don't do them. I haven't done them for.
You did?
I had a phase. How long? I think a good one, like a 1.5 month very hard run, and then like a 3 or 4 month very hard run a couple months later after that.
Very and then hard I so- run for 3 or 4 months. That sounds intense.
I should write about that exactly what I was doing during that period of time because it was I was living out Charlotte. What do you say?
Were you doing drugs with like, were you like dating a girl and doing it with a girl? Were you doing it with a group of friends? Were you kind of doing it on your own with the like different people?
First time group of friends that I met got me into certain things very often, had a lot of fun. And then the second time was with a girl for most of the time. That was just me and her, and we would do it with friends and we would go out and we go out all the time and it's way too much. But and then came back to the States and sort of just went to festivals a bunch and did it at festivals a bunch. And then I was like, all right, I got to like figure out my life here. And then I stopped. I mean, it seemed pretty easy to stop. So when people, I mean, I can understand people not wanting to stop because the feeling it gives you is just like, I mean, it's a really other world type feeling that you might not get from normal life, especially if your life's in a bad place and you don't see any it getting better. But for me at the time, I felt like I had to reestablish myself as for poker and not for partying and not for traveling to go to festivals and not for all that type of stuff that goes into that sort of thing. So that was it. That was my run, man. That was my, it was a run. Then since then, you know, that was in 2000 and end of 2012 and then beginning of 2013. Okay. Yeah. And then since then off and on, maybe once a year or something like that. If that,
how old are you?
30.
Wow.
That it's young or old, you're 34 year old man. I mean, but 30.
I know everyone's so fucking young. Yeah.
I would certainly like which book. Has he read The Island by Aldous Huxley?
No.
I would like that book. Well, thank you. I'll check it out. Someone mentioned the book The Flow earlier as well. A lot of good books. We got some fucking really GTO, really GTO book recommendations over time for sure on the pod.
That's a nice friend benefit right there.
Yeah. I want to read about that drugs experience you had. I was out of line for sure. Olivier, do you have any funny, interesting Durr stories? Big J2104 wants to ask.
Not really. I mean, I think it was like one of the first years, maybe the first year I was ever at PCA. This was before Durr was like big time. He like bet 5K that he wouldn't jump in the shark tank, and then the area.
He really jumped in that fucking shark tank?
Yeah, he did. I mean, he waited for like the sharks to be somewhere, like to have swum away. But yeah, he like jumped and then jumped out. Yeah, I was there for that. I think it was 5K or something.
What time was it? Was it like, night or?
Yeah, well, yeah, it was at night. Yeah, definitely. It was like, I don't know, maybe like 11 or 12. I don't think it was that late, but it was dark and it was pretty late.
What a fucking idiot.
Yeah. I think I went to PCA that year. It was me, Dustin Dirksen, and the two Bilzerian brothers. And then I think there was a couple of girls that they brought with them.
They bought them from Instagram even back then, 2006, before Instagram was around, huh?
Before Instagram, man. This is when, the Bilzerian, Dan Bilzerian was not the same level that he is now. Do you know Dustin Dirksen? Do you know who that guy is at all?
I know of him. There was a recent video I posted with him and my Ludwig Geilig. We just had him on a podcast. They played some PLO hands together. But
I saw that, actually.
Yeah, the commentary on that was the funniest fucking commentary I've ever heard in my entire life.
Well, and that's why it was funny to you, because the commentary, okay.
Yeah, the commentary was just like, I mean, the guy was, I mean, he's called Jack 10-7-3 with three suits. He opened under the gun, called a three bet, called a four bet. And he said it was a strong call preflop. I go, what the fuck is this guy talking? I mean, it's not a strong call. But Jackson 7-3 with three hearts. It's not a fucking strong call at any point in time, any situation at any point in time.
Can I just ask you just like a basic question? What does strong call mean? I've never understood that expression. That's a strong call. What does that mean?
I mean, if someone says the term a strong call, I assume they're a fun player.
Okay. It's just like a way of, I almost feel like it's a way of like insulting someone. Make a strong call. I don't even know I don't know what that expression means.
I don't know what it means. I mean,
what type of hand do you need to have to make a strong call? Do you need to make a strong hand? You have to have a strong hand?
Obviously not. If Jack 10-7-3 with three hearts
I thought you were saying he was misusing that term.
I don't know what the fuck he was doing. I don't know what he's talking about. What are we talking about? It didn't make sense. He said guy shouldn't have bet three aces on the river on ace queen jack. Because it's obvious his opponent had King 10 when it certainly was not obvious his opponent had King 10. And one of the most ridiculous, it's fine. I'm going to get tilted here a little bit more.
I remember I watched that video because it was like a blast from the past, because I was boys with Dustin. I miss that guy. He's I really liked him. He's cool.
What happened to him? He shows up in Iowa randomly and that's it, or what?
I think he's from Iowa. And he lives in Iowa. I don't know if he still lives there. I think he's a dad. I think he's been a dad for a while. So I think he was kind of limited in how much he could travel. Him and I just kind of lost contact. But he was one of the first people that I like met in poker. I think you had to have been around, especially Full Tilt at the time that he came on, to fully understand how much that kid just changed the game. He was one of those kids where when he came in, everyone started playing differently, because he was just crushing and doing things that other people were not doing, that people didn't understand. They had to try to take time to understand. Obviously, he ran good too, but he just came in from like low, like I don't even know, like 5'10", and he would have like these massive stacks sitting by himself, just like having destroyed everyone that sat with him. I mean, it was amazing. It was pretty cool.
Did he play No Limit or PLO? Just PLO at that time?
No, it was just No Limit at that time. This is a long time ago. It was like 07. This is a long time ago, 08 or something. And this was before anybody was playing PLO.
What was his he's not Gigabet. That's not him. That's someone else, right?
No, that's another guy with one of his names is similar.
Yeah.
I don't maybe that guy's name is Dustin something else or something.
Maybe. Someone in the chat said that. I can't remember his real name though. Can't remember what Olivia. What?
No, it's definitely not Gigabet. Gigabet's much skinnier, different kid.
This guy. We got a real good question here, Olivia. Did you wax your chest for the ripped topless end boss shot you took?
Shave.
You shaved your chest, really?
Yeah, I mean, I shave my chest like every week. Yeah, it's I can't wax. It fucks with my skin. It gets all irritated and shit. I used to, like, when I was married, my wife liked it, like, the hair, so I let it grow. But I always liked it clean.
So you shave your chest once a week?
Yes. Is that really that weird? I don't know. Maybe it's weird.
I don't know. I see most people. I didn't know people shave their chest. Honestly, I didn't know.
It's a real thing. They sell specific razor blades just for that.
No shit.
Well, maybe not just for that, but for body, yeah. For guys' bodies, yeah. I don't know.
It might be like a potential article next time to write about your process.
I don't think so.
Why not? I mean, I want to know. I want to, like, I want to see what it's like. Shave your chest once a week. Like, for fun. It's got a He's got a geez, man.
I really didn't expect that to be a thing that like that made you react.
I didn't know. What's my Cam? Come back, Cam. I just didn't know. I mean, the eyebrows. I'm sure I knew he's a hairy guy, but I didn't think he shaved his chest. It looks like he has a ton of chest hair. Yeah, that's definitely not the case for sure. Definitely not the case. Does he shave his butt? All right, guys, a couple more questions. Were you shave? Stop shaving your nails. I mean, listen, people want to know. Yeah, like once a week's a lot. The chat agrees. Like once a week's a lot. Like that's
the chat agrees. The chat agrees. Great.
Listen, if I've come to learn anything, it's that the chat and 2 + 2, those guys know about everything.
That's what you've learned.
They know about everything.
Yeah, they do.
My chest is shaved. Come on, let's know it's not. All right, guys, a couple more questions, and then we'll wrap it up. How long we get today, man? Throughout the 3 hour, almost a 3 hour mark, kid.
What is the longest pod you've ever done?
Well, me and Hollywood set the record, and then let me check out the length on that one. And then me and Fedor just completely destroyed the record. The next two days at the PCA, me and Hollywood did a really epic one that was, I think it was 3 hours. Let me get the right time. I want to remember how long this one was. It was live in person. What'd you say?
Fader is a special guy.
We podcasted a bunch together, but then we were drinking in this one and there was like competitions. My girlfriend at the time was there and she was involved in the competitions. And it was, the Hollywood one was 3 hours and 23 minutes.
Okay.
And then the Fader one was 4 hours and 57 minutes.
Whoa.
It was a lot. It was people like some people like messaged like watch the entire thing. Like they were like, this is like the sickest, funniest podcast. Cause we were super, like, we were wasted by like 2.5 hours in. And
was it a podcast where you were together or you were
we were together in person. All the PCA one, me, I did with one, a moneymaker, Haxton, and then Fedor. We were all together like on the couch.
Okay. That's a little different.
Yeah. It was, the live podcasts are good. Remember, I see if you were going to LA, I wanted to do one with you out there, or if you were going to be out there, but you went to San Jose.
Yeah, I did not make it to LA.
LA's fun. You don't like LA?
I don't really know LA that well. I forget. I think I was training, and I just wasn't gonna take that much time.
Yeah. Ask him how his chess game. Okay. Would he have been more successful right now had he stuck with his hedge fund career? And Boss 22 wants to know.
I mean, that's one of those questions. Like, who knows? If you're judging success by like the amount of money I would have made, I mean, I don't know. I've done pretty well in poker, to be honest. But the ceiling in hedge funds is obviously infinitely higher. So, would I have been good at trading or good at, you know, I don't know. It's something I think about every once in a while, but there's so many things that this particular path has led me towards that I just would never trade, that I'm good where I'm at. I'm happy with the decisions I've made. I think regret is pretty silly and counterproductive. So I don't know.
Definitely agree. I think everything you go through, you can take something away. There's no reason to wish it didn't happen or hate that it happened or, you know, try to like let it affect you instead of some stuff that people probably don't follow, but you know, in
more
theory,
philosophical
like,
shit from the guy who doesn't pursue any philosophy.
Me?
Yeah.
Oh, I mean, man, like my poker, you know, that drug time, that also coincided with me losing a lot of my money at the time. You know, I'm on a massive upswing and then you lose like 500K, you know, you could regret. There's a person that might regret that, but I pretty much realized pretty quickly, like, hey, you know, I fucked up. I got myself in a situation. I fucked. I could have been set for a while. I'm not going to be set for a while, you know, from a financial monetary standpoint. So I got to get over it. I got to, you know, it ain't coming back. Yeah. And that was it. I couldn't, you know, I mean, I felt like people let that haunt them forever. They let it haunt, like, what if I made this, or what if I did this, or what if I did that? Whereas you made the decision you make the best of it, embrace what it is, and figure out a way to make it successful, however you determine success is in that situation. Yeah, with money, I mean, that's something that could eat someone up alive forever, man. You know, if I was working at Subway, I guess I might feel a little differently about this situation, but yeah.
Life lessons with Poppy,
yes, sir. Let me find one more question. You got any questions for me, kid? Anything at all? Anything you want to ask? We talked about a lot of stuff today.
Yeah, we did. Do you have, what are your plans, man? Like, what are you gonna do? Like, are you gonna continue this pass for like five more years? Like, what are you thinking?
For the podcast?
Just for your life.
Great question. I'm not sure. I was planning to move at the beginning of the year, and then I met the girl, and so we got, you know, met her last year.
You knew where you were gonna move?
I was probably gonna move back to San Diego or to Vegas.
Okay.
And that got in the way. I don't know, man. I'm not really sure where I'm going to be. I like being around here because my family's here. My little bro's here. Tutu Andrew Cool, a.k.a. Big Dog, a.k.a. Yarsick, a.k.a. Stallion. And my mom, my fam's here. So, yeah, I know. He makes appearances on the pod all the time. He's the man. Everyone loves him. But yeah, I'm not, you know, I don't know, man. I got the podcast. I've just started writing more on my website. I'm going to
be- I noticed that. I think it's cool.
Yeah, I want to do a lot more written content. I feel like, you know, these podcasts, like, there's so much gold in them, but at the same time, the people, like, are just not going to listen to anything past an hour. People aren't going to listen to some things that are 30 minutes. Yeah. So I'm trying to make those more accessible with the timestamps, with the recaps, with just getting more in-depth into them. And then I just want to write more because I feel like, you know, I'm sure, like, you've been in poker so long. Like, if you really sat down and just paced around, like, I do my best stuff. I pace back and forth, man. I'm drinking a bottle of water. That's my best thinking. Okay. But if you just write down all the ideas in your head pertaining to poker, not even poker specific strategies, but just like general poker, motivation, work ethic, sacrifice, recovering, taking breaks, pushing through, all the, like, if you just take those things and then you can break those down into so many other things. Like, I've just written down so many things that I could write about from that standpoint, not to mention commentary type stuff like I did for you in the fight, you know, like just writing about things like that, that I think people would enjoy reading about, or it would give them a different perspective, or a, you know, cause people want these things discussed, but they don't know where to go to get them discussed. So, you know, give them a place. End goal. There's really an end goal. I just really enjoy doing the podcast. Like, I think people seem to really enjoy them. The messages I get, the feedback's great. I just enjoy talking with people. Like, I talk with, you know, somebody like yourself or somebody like Dan, or, you know, you talk with the guys who are the best in the thing you're most passionate about for the past 8 years of your life, which, you know, myself. And I mean, that's fucking cool. I mean, it's pretty cool, right? Like, you know, I've grinded so hard at poker, and that's been like the only thing I've thought about for so long. And now you get to talk with other people who have done the same exact thing. And those people typically tend to be people who have other really intelligent thoughts to add about life just in general. And I think you learn a lot, you get great conversation. And I think people who are also love poker or like poker can really get a lot just from listening, whether it's from entertainment or whether it's motivated or whether it's get a little inspired or just fucking enjoy their time out there and whatever their job is or whatever it is they're doing. And yeah, I think podcasts is, I'll still be doing that for a while, do more written stuff. Just kind of see where it goes. Yeah, you know, I don't know where it goes. Maybe we'll make some money off it somehow. I'm not sure really, but I don't know. Just fun. It's something fun to do.
Cool. So
I think that's the idea. What about you, kid? Where do you think things going now, man? Poker? Are you taking the break? You got into fighting? You obviously, like, you know, you always knew you had this ability to like do whatever, but now you fucking know for sure you can kind of do whatever. I mean, now you kind of, you know, you're 34. Is it something you're thinking about? You got to make a decision on something. You want to make a decision on something for the next.
Yeah.
You know, as you get older, or is it something where you're like, let me give it a couple more years and then let me decide exactly, you know, what it is I might be extremely passionate about?
No, I think I'm going to make a decision pretty quickly. I mean, I think the first thing I'm going to do is probably take the GREs and see if I do well. And, potentially start to pursue a master's in economics, potentially, if I like it, potentially pursue a PhD. I wanna, you know, I think economics is a really interesting field. I think it's something that I would have a natural aptitude for and have a natural interest in. And I think it's a field that is important in the sense that economic decisions are very fundamental to our society and affect people's lives in real basic and important ways. So it like hits a bunch of things that I think are important for me, right? My natural aptitude, my natural interest, it has significance in the world. It has real impact. So, I mean, I also think there's a number of interesting potential professional paths that come from economics, right? So, I mean, you can work in academia, you can work in research, you can work in public policy, you can work in the financial world. All of those things have varying degrees of interest to me. I'm not sure if any one of them would be something I'd want to pursue full stop, but having a career that had some sort of, you know, that kind of pulled from those different fields to a certain extent, is something that I think would be really fulfilling and interesting. And I just, you know, as I foresee my life, my personal life becoming more settled, falling in love again and having a family, I don't want to be traveling all the time. And I'd like to be in the US, and I don't even think my career in online poker is that much, is going to survive that much longer. But I don't want to be traveling and playing live tournaments all the time, especially with young kids. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I need to find something that will, like, the rest of my life will, I can pursue.
Do you think that, is that probably going to be a career working for something else, or do you have any interest in entrepreneurship, or, you know, maybe doing something on your own after you maybe learn something? I don't know exactly, you know, what it could be, but I'm sure there's something that you could, you know, tie in those skills that you have already and then what you might learn, and then figure out a way to still make a contribution, or feel like you're making a contribution, or feel like you're making a difference, you know, in that particular field.
Yeah, I mean, I think entrepreneurship, the idea of working for yourself, is like extremely alluring and like awesome, especially coming from this background where, you know, we all know what it is to not have to like report to someone and all that shit.
Right. And so stay motivated and work hard in that process. You know, a lot right, of people, right.
Yeah, I know that. Yeah. So, I mean, that would be great. I think at this point, it's still so early for me that I just don't, I don't have this clear singular path with an obvious destination. And I also, part of me thinks that's good because I'm so ignorant. The more I progress in my path and the more I learn, I think the more clear potential destinations will become. And then I'll be in a better place to like make those types of decisions. But yeah, having an opportunity to like work for myself, and, you know, I, you know, one thing that I, you know, when I grew up in a house where both of my parents essentially worked like 8 to 8 or 7 to 8 every day. And, you know, they work super hard, and I have a lot of respect for that. But personally, I want to be able to like go to my kids' basketball game and help them with their homework when, you know, when they come home from school and stuff. So I just, I would love to have flexibility in my job. That is something that would be really awesome. So hopefully I can find a way to do that. And also, like, I want to be able to like spend time with the person that I fall in love with. And that was one thing that was amazing when I was married. She didn't work and I had this job, so we could like spend all the time that we wanted together, which was when it was good, was awesome. I really liked that part of it. I know a lot of my friends, it's just tougher because they, you know, like a normal person, they get up, they go to work all day, then they come back at night and they get to spend a couple hours maybe with their family or with their wives, and then part of the weekend if they don't work on the weekends. And that's a, you know, that's a life, especially in New York City. It's a life that is very common, but it's not the way that I envision my 40s and 50s. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. I think something you said about kind of learning stuff and then not really have, it's like something I talked about earlier today as well. It's like not really setting a goal, but it's like you don't set an end goal for yourself. You sort of go along with the process. And as you go along with the process, things open up that you never anticipated open up, whether like there's right. opportunities and things come, you don't even imagine it could be exist because you just don't know it yet. But as you start learning the skills, or as you start, you know, being in that world, things evolve. So it's like, and so instead of having that big end goal, it's approach it as it comes, take it as it comes. And then things will open up along the path if you can really do that.
Yeah, I mean, I remember one of the first conversations I had with my friend Joe, who was really instrumental in like a lot of the elements of my fight. He was talking about jiu-jitsu, and he was like, you know, one thing that you'll get is you'll get vision. Your vision will become more and more clear. Your ability to see things will become more clear. And I think that's not just true of jiu-jitsu. That's just true in general. Like, as you learn and progress and advance, your vision changes. You start to be able to see things that you didn't see before, make connections between things that you couldn't make connections with. And then those connections lead to things that you just didn't have the capacity or ability to see or to understand. So like, yeah, it's the things that you don't even know that you don't know that are super important. And like, and I think also like part of what I was describing with Dan, like you have to also, to get to a point where you can start to see, you got to make some concrete decisions. You got to be like, okay, sure, my opportunity costs are high, but I'm willing to, you know, I'm willing to take it. I'm willing to take a chance, make a decision, go in a certain direction, and then kind of go from there. And that's a risk, and it's, you know, but at the same time, it's the only way that you can start to see some of those things you couldn't otherwise see.
It's kind of like you take the risk, and no matter what the outcome is, you can make it positive. Whether you fail, you learn from your failures. But if you succeed, well, then you succeed. So, I think a lot of people look at failure as this bad thing, and it's really hard to. I mean, I don't know. You got to go through a lot of fucking failure at things. Whether it's like whether you fail at something simple like playing ball or playing basketball or playing a video game. I mean, you learn from these failures, and you learn how to not fail at what you're doing. And if you're smart about it, you can sort of take those things and then put it into other things and transfer it over. And then, I mean, it just helps you get better at things that you do. And I mean, I think it can help incentivize you to want to learn something new or want to try new things or learn something. I mean, learn about philosophy sort of thing like that. Like, I mean, I can go learn about, I'll want to go learn about philosophy now. And I'll have the confidence that I can actually, you know, focus and put my time in and actually learn about it. Whereas maybe before when I was younger, I wouldn't have thought I could do it because that, you know, just didn't have the belief in myself that I could even learn something that, like, you know what I mean? Like, it's just, which kind of.
No, I think, yeah, what you're saying about failure is like so important and can't be like stated like strongly enough. Like your perspective on failure is like really, really important. And I think also it also helps develop self-knowledge, which I think is really key. Understanding yourself, how you work. Like even for example, like my chat ban, like the fact that I banned my own chat, like this was just something where I was just like, okay, I have this leak and I have to address it. You know what I mean? I wasn't like, okay, you know, for a while I was just like, all right, I'm just not going to engage with these clowns, you know? Mm-hmm. And then I just couldn't help myself. And I would just repeat old patterns. And I was just like, at some point you just have to understand that like you are fallible, imperfect, you know, you have strengths and you have weaknesses. You need to work on your weaknesses and, you know, acknowledge them, learn how to develop them. And then sometimes like be willing to just, whatever the meta analogy is of banning chat, but just like understanding how, what your limitations are and where your strengths are and, you know, how you can succeed based on your specific mix of qualities. And failure is super, super good for teaching yourself that.
I think in that situation, it's kind of like a discipline thing in a way. It's like you're not disciplined enough to be able to stop yourself from doing it.
Right.
So you can eliminate it. But I think it has you can apply it to other things. So, you know, what if you can't stop yourself? What if you don't have the discipline to be smart in a situation, but you can't just stop that thing? And then it's like, I mean, I'm sure I have that problem with some things too. I just don't have the discipline in some areas. How do you stop it? And how do you get the discipline though? I don't know. It's tough it's a challenge, I think.
I mean, that's why like the websites themselves have the ability to just like ban yourself from the website, right? You can like, you can lock yourself out for 24 hours, right? But like the sites have those things because they understand that sometimes you have a desire, but you can't control yourself in certain situations. So like, you know that you can't. So you have this higher level discipline that just like, is like, okay, I'm going to ban myself. So no matter how much I want to, I can't play for a day. And I think it requires a level of humility and self-knowledge that's like really good. And you know, the ability to apply that in other circumstances is important.
Yeah.
Because otherwise, you know, you have people who are just delusional about their own abilities and about their own lack of weaknesses or whatever, and they think they can do everything, or you know, they don't seek help when they need it or when it would really be beneficial, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I'm trying to do better at that. You mentioned the seeking help thing, surrounding yourself with people. Earlier, you talked about this.
So
you're good at surrounding yourself with people who are knowledgeable about what it is you're trying to do or what you're doing, and that's something that I am trying to do more. But it's poker, it's so like solo, you know, it's so like you yourself. And like,
I don't know if that's true. I mean, look, my experience for poker has been incredibly solo, like incredibly solo. But, you know, I was thinking about it, you know, I was like, imagine if my best friends were Scott Seaver, Justin Bonomo, Steve O'Dwyer, like, I was in a Skype chat with these guys, and then whenever I went to tournaments, we would have dinner together, stay in the same room together. Like, imagine if that is your experience. Like, you're gonna get really fucking good. You know what I mean? Like, for some people, and I think a lot of very successful people, look at the Evil Empire. That, you know, this group of people, collaboration and support is like super important for getting, not just getting good, but accelerating the process of getting good. Mm-hmm. You know, that, and I think that for me is the key. It's like, especially with this fight, it was like, I have to do this in a certain amount of time. I got to be as efficient and effective as possible. Like, I got to do this fast, you know? So I got to get people who will help accelerate my learning. So yeah, I mean, I think it's really, really important. You know, Malcolm Gladwell wrote this book that every single person like who reads books has read, and talks about, right? One thing is this 10,000 hour rule, right? Mm-hmm. And for me, I think, you know, he talks a little bit more about 10,000 hours than just the amount of time involved. But it's like, there's a very, very wide range of quality of practice. You know, you can practice something on your own. Sometimes you can practice something where you have a bad habit that you reinforce.
Right.
But practicing something where you are mentally engaged, focused, motivated, where you have someone who is with you, supporting you, helping you, teaching you, you know, that it's those number of hours that are really key. You know, just like being by yourself and just like whatever it is, playing poker, you know, over and over again, like there's a limited amount of value that's going to bring. But if you can figure out the best way to learn and then use that time and try to use that time as much as possible, then you can really start to make a big, big dent into the learning curve, I think.
I didn't know that you put that caveat in there where the 10,000 hours, but make the hours quality. I mean, if talking about basketball, when I learned basketball, I just learned, like, I went and played. I didn't have a coach. I never knew how to play besides for a couple years ago. So I played a bit when I was a kid, but I just started a couple years ago and I watched YouTube videos and I just went on the court and played. But I put so many hours in to get, you know, pretty good at basketball, but the quality of those hours could not have been, I mean, I had to have been doing so many things unoptimally for so many hours. And I think for poker, I was the same way, especially PLO. But, let's say right now
I was like, all right, let's make a bet and we're going to bet and we're going to play one-on-one in 3 months. Like, would you do the same thing that you just did? That you described you did in the beginning, like you look at YouTube videos and go on the court and play by yourself?
I think I would have to probably get a coach from that situation.
Yeah, you would like you'd probably figure out like the best drills that you could do to work on your handle and work on your shot. You wouldn't even care about playing 3-on-3 or 5-on-5. You'd focus just on 1-on-1.
Yeah.
You'd like figure out my size and like try to play against people who are my, you know what I mean? You would do all these things that were super specific, super geared towards your goal. You would have someone who like was really good at the thing you were trying to do and have them work with you and try to teach you as best they could. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I think that's my biggest takeaway from today is that I need to, even, I mean, anything, like there's something like I went to the chiropractor because I had some back, because some people are going to say chiropractor's fucking wonky, whatever. All right, that's fine.
Chiropractors are the shit. You find a good chiropractor, they can really help.
That's what I'm saying, man. My guy, he played ball too. I was like, this guy's like, he like helped me so much in stretches, gave me some good stuff, helped my back, took away my power. I was like, this is like perfect. But
the problem, I want to hear what you're saying. The problem that I've experienced with chiropractors and this type of thing is that for every good chiropractor, there's probably 5 or 6 people who are not good, who are fake, who are full of shit. And that's why the overall profession or job gets a bad rep. But that doesn't mean that there aren't good ones who are like, can really help. But go, sorry, go ahead.
No, I guess what I took away from that was like, all this time, you know, here I had this thing going on. I could have just went to this professional who's been doing this for the past 8 to 10 plus, maybe 20 years. And he just shows me it exactly right then. But with all these other things, I don't like take advantage of that. I don't do that. You know, it's like, and I have the capacity to do it. I have the resources to do it. I just don't do it. I don't reach out to the people who know the industry best or know that field best, whether it's, you know, something like chiropractor, something like, you know, like skincare, for instance. And I guess I have done that in the past, but shout out to the esthetician out there in the world who've helped me out. But, you know, just a lot of things, I guess, you know, even like I so many things I could have learned smarter. And I guess that's the thing I need to work at a little better too. Even like all this stuff, business stuff, entrepreneur stuff. Like I just sort of learn on the fly. I'm just like, read a book, read a couple of books, read some articles, and like try things, like try and fail. Like that's how I learned, trial and error, basically.
I mean, I'm sure there's a ton of value to doing that too. I mean, I think trying stuff on your own, trial and error, figuring stuff out. I mean, I don't think that's probably bad, but yeah, I mean, it sounds like you would benefit from asking for help more.
Yeah. Well,
and also I think you might be surprised. I mean, I don't, maybe not you, but some people in general, like some people think that, like, you know, when you ask for help, that's either a sign of weakness or that like people don't really want to help. Like people want to help, you know, like there's a lot of people who are just like, they're just chill people, good people who just want to help. I mean, you know, it's not like I don't think we live in a world where everyone's just like wants to do their own thing. I think when you're not a dick and you like ask for help and you do it in a genuine way, like people want to help.
Yeah. I read something recently where when you ask someone for help, it actually shows them that you respect them, or you that, right. Like it makes them feel good about it, because like, here's this person's coming to you for help on something. Like they must really put you up somewhere in their mind. And they actually are very inclined to want to help you out in that situation.
Yeah.
That was interesting.
Yeah, I remember seeing this like research, I don't know, whatever, like experiment where it was like, if you ask someone for help for like some small task, like let's say you're like moving a couch, like from, you know, off of a truck or something, and it's like really heavy. If you ask someone just to help you, and then compare that to offering them a small amount of money to help you, people are more likely to help you when you don't offer them money.
Really?
Yeah, because like I think the idea is people are inclined generally to help. But once you introduce a financial aspect, it changes the dynamic. And now it's like there's some tit for tat transactional aspect to it. And a lot of the time people just like, it's not enough money and it's a small thing and people just they don't want to be bothered, and it just changes the calculation in their mind. But when you just ask them just like, will you be just like, just be a nice guy for 5 minutes? Then people are much more likely to say yes, because it just plays to a different part of the way that they're thinking about things, rather than you being like, hey, and I'll give you $5. I thought that was a cool experiment.
Interesting. I mean, I guess I don't ask for help much. I wouldn't know, but I mean, it's interesting to know. Yeah, yeah, poker. I mean, poker, like, it's, you know, I definitely learned how to play Nolan Hold'em with a lot of friends back in Chicago back in the day. But over the time, you know, I don't know. Switching games, all my friends were Nolan Hold'em players coming into PLO. You know, not many of my main friends were PLO players, so I sort of, I didn't really reach out to like add new people to the circle. I was just mainly.
Who are like your closest friends from poker?
Who are they before?
Or I don't know now.
I think, I mean, I guess before thinking about it, it really changed because I moved out of Chicago. Like they all quit. Like I had my friend Chris DeShornman. Back in the day, we lived in San Diego. We somehow made the move. We somehow got out of Indiana. We moved to fucking San Diego, baby. I don't know how we did it, man. But I think I had 15K. He had 2K or something like that. We made it work somehow to get out there. But yeah, like I had my Chicago friends. I had my full ring small micro stakes friends. And then I moved up way faster than they did. And then I, you know, sort of started having small stakes friends. And I had mainly friends from online because, you know, most of them didn't live around the same area. So San Diego, I had a couple friends, my boy BW, Brian Wilbur, #SaveBrian. You know, I've been on the pod once or twice. And then a couple of our guys out there who don't play poker anymore. And, you know, that's kind of it. I moved to Vancouver. I had good poker friends there, but then they all left. And
what about now?
Now, I think it's like I have a lot of friends who, when I see them, like it'll be like we're best friends for that period of time. Like my buddy George, or you know, George Sintosh, or, you know, even if I hang out with LaFord, if we're, you know, we're really good friends and we're together, but it's like, I'm never really by people and I don't travel that much. So, you know, a lot of relationships are online and I don't go on Skype that much just cause, you know, I don't spend too much time just chatting with people for the most part. So that part has been challenging, just maintaining the friendships and growing them and building them. Cause I feel like now that I have like, you know, 10, 15 guys that I'd be extremely good friends with, but it's just a matter of figuring out how to like do that, but not see the person in real life ever.
Yeah. I've struggled like developing and maintaining friendships in poker. I think especially when I was married, my ex-wife was not big on like socializing with poker players, and I was always traveling with her, and then when I wasn't playing tournaments, like spending with her, because you know that was all, the only time we had together. So that was something that I wanted to try to make more of an effort for, like recently.
Interesting. Yeah, I guess that's kind of how I always, my friendships were with women. You know, I'm a professional dater. I'm not a professional relationship person, but I've always excelled at date, the idea of dating, you know, that dating that first 2-3 weeks, that month, or that period I crushed. That past that, I'm fucking fishing so hard, I don't know what's happening. But I always put like my friendships in those relationships sort of thing. I'd spend so much time with them and then they'd become my best friend, and you know, they'd learn about poker, and that was, you know, just the idea of making, you know, like a poker friend or making friends from poker. I guess now they all sort of the same thing, but that's
Are you
been
a professional heartbreaker?
Oh yeah, for sure. Jesus Christ, man. Yes. Yes. It's bad. Honestly, it's bad. It's bad. How do you know about that? You think you get, yeah, it makes sense. It adds up, right?
Yeah.
It adds up. You weren't like that? It's not how you were back in the day?
No, I mean, look, it's, you know, I have this big span of time, you know, where I was with one person.
How long were you with her for?
7 years.
Holy fuck.
Yeah, we were married for 4. We were together for 7.
Shit. So 33 till 26?
Yeah.
So out of college, when did you graduate? How old were you, 22, 23?
No, like, I think I was still 21, about to turn 22. I was
21, got a job in the city in New York?
I didn't right away. I was like dicking around for like 6 or 9 months, and then got a job at a trading firm for like a year, and then at the hedge fund for like 2 years. And then I was like 25, and then that's when poker was like took over. And so that was about 10 years ago, like 9.5, 10 years ago.
Damn. And with one person, man, now you're like, you're at a completely different point in life, completely different mindset, completely different confidence point. Completely, I mean, every shit, man, everything now.
Literally, it feels like multiple lives ago.
Fuck, man, that's gotta be.
Also, like, I look totally different, you know? It's like so many things are different.
Well, how'd you look back then when you were that young? Were you like?
I was skinny. I was much skinnier. I cut my hair recently, so I had long hair for a while.
We were talking about.
Whoa, my phone just went ballistic for no reason. So, yeah, I mean, I looked different. I felt different. I mean, everyone is different after 7 or 8 years, you know, but
yeah,
I was in a different place for sure.
Dark Fang said, can you elaborate why the relationship didn't work? Was poker any part of it? Of course. I mean, come on. Yes. 100%. Yes, poker. Yeah, poker is hard to sacrifice.
Yeah, I don't really want to get into like specific stuff from my divorce, but poker was... Not as much a part of it as you might think, to be honest. Poker was kind of good for us because, like I said, it allowed us to really spend a lot of time together. And that was really good. But it would just, I just think we had different ideas of what it meant to be like fundamentally long-term supportive of one another. And it was just, yeah, it was a tough time to like end it.
I found a picture of you with longer hair. You look different.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, if you like came on the pod now and then said this is, I mean, I guess I kind of see it, but not really. Not some of these.
Somebody on my Facebook posted a picture of me from Poker After Dark. And then me, like, it was literally like after, like right after the fight, doing a post-fight interview. So I had like blood on my face and shit. And it was just like, look at this transformation. And that was, I don't know, probably 5 years ago. That's like a, I mean, yeah, I look different. Definitely.
Hmm. People in chat, check out that bicep vein. What the fuck, man? Yeah, the vein's killing it right now, kid. That vein game strong, Poppy. I mean, the naturalness has been working. Been having a GTO effect.
Yo, you goddamn better not be fucking trolling me with the naturalness comment.
the natural. I'm curious. I really want to know. Hopefully, people will get to listen to that part about the pod, and hopefully, maybe people can. Stop with all the
doubt. I honestly, the one thing I've realized is that when people are dead set in a point of view, like it's not content and reason that will change their mind, you know?
It's not proof that'll change their mind either. I don't think it's
well, that's the thing. A lot of times people are super confident about something that is unprovable. specifically because it is unprovable. So their level of confidence can just be like completely out of whack, you know, because they can't be proven wrong.
Yeah, that's how a lot of debaters are. They can't be proven wrong because they don't have logic or reason. They're not going to listen to what you say and give it any sort of credence. They're just going to not even listen to what you're fucking saying and just go with what they're saying because they're so dead set that they're correct about it.
Yeah.
Looks like the vein of my cock, Mike says. That might mean it's time to wrap things up. Olivier, let's do- Anytime the comments are coming, it looks like the vein of my cock. I mean, you know.
How many people are still watching this? Like four?
Couple hundred, man. Couple hundred, Poppy. I think we got 200 on the YouTubes right now, and I probably got 100 or 200 on the Twitch side of things. Could have some crossover there, but yeah, a lot of people. I mean, I think this will get a lot of views.
Yo, so much love to people. I mean, not that everyone's necessarily been here the whole time, but that's
what I say. I'm like, listen, if anyone listens to these things for 3 fucking hours, like that's and people all the time message me, man. Listen, and this 2:48 mark, 2:48 in, you said message me. I'm still listening. I'm still here. I'm like, damn, that's. I mean, you can check the audience retention rate on YouTube, and I mean, some of the podcasts with, you know, like the Dan podcast has, what is that, like 24,000 views now. I mean, the retention rate on that one's pretty good, and so it's
24,000 views. What a boss!
I know, man. Yeah, they definitely like that one. That one got a lot of really good, a lot of good feedback, a lot of good words out there on all different platforms. I'm sure this one will definitely be the same. Yeah, the more popular guys like the sauce. I think the sauce one's like my biggest non-Dan Negrano one. It's got like 50K on there, so
50K views.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, how much does Negrano have?
I think the first one has like 70 or 80 or something like that.
That's not even that much of a difference.
Yeah, I mean, it's plus the Negrano one's an hour and the sauce one's like 3 hours. So, I mean, you're going to be more inclined to want to click on one from Negrano. That's also shorter in length too. Yeah.
How long ago was your one with Negrano?
About a little over 1 year ago.
Okay.
Yeah. And then the other one was the Negrano with Poker Stars Changes, that one. Right.
That one I saw.
Yeah, when Anski joined in, that was that one did pretty well too. So
props to Anski for taking the helm for the poker community, you know?
Yeah, man, he was battling there for a little bit, so I'm not sure what's been happening with that lately, though.
Yeah.
Guys, where can they – so if people want to check it out anymore with Olivier, you can follow his Twitter. Is it at Olivier Busquet, your name, right?
Yeah.
Where else you'd be writing anything, blogging, updating? Where else can people want to get updates on anything, what you're up to?
Yeah, mostly Twitter. I might write a couple blogs here and there. You know what? If people have specific blog entry ideas, feel free to drop them on my Twitter notifications. Like, one of my problems with writing is just that I don't think I have tons of great ideas, and I don't want to just write for the sake of writing. So if people come up with like cool ideas and I think I can like say something that I think is insightful or interesting or just something valuable, then I'm open to any idea. So
you need the master idea list that I have. I was telling someone, I feel like if a poker company out there would have to pay thousands of dollars for this list that I have of ideas of just any content of all different types. It's like literally, I feel like a poker site should pay money for these fucking ideas I have written down in this thing. That's dope. It's pretty well. I'm a professional idea person, Poppy. I'm not necessarily a professional executor quite yet in my life, so.
Yo, professional idea person sounds like pretty good. Pretty good start.
His Twitter is at cockvane.
Is that Mike again? I hope that's the same guy.
Yes, of course it is Mike. Shout out to Mike, man. He's only said a couple of things. He said poker. When we talked about women, he said poker. Yeah, that's her name or something. I don't know. He made a reference off poker. I don't know, man. I don't know. This guy's – he said nothing. I've never seen the fucking guy in the chat before. He comes up with 3 comments. He's crushing it, man. We're someone make the Twitter name Olivier Busquet's cock vein, please, or something of that nature. And
let's not do that. Can we give one more shout out to Lasagna just to say what's up?
She's still watching?
I don't know.
Can't be. There's no fucking too big time to be watching this part, kid. Come on. She says she's excited for the podcast, but she ain't gonna be watching this long, man. There ain't no. If she hears this and she recognizes you, I'm gonna be shocked. I'll be shocked. I'll buy something. I don't know what it is. I'm gonna buy something if that's true, because I'm impressed.
You're gonna buy something? What are you gonna buy?
I'm gonna buy her something.
No, buy me something. Fuck that.
I'll buy her something.
Yeah.
I don't know what though. I'll buy her a fucking. I don't know. What do you buy for the person that's everything? I'm not sure. Honestly,
let's end it there.
Yeah, I don't know, man. Blessed, man. Hashtag blessed. I'm like, I don't even want to read that comment. All right, guys, I'm out. Olivier, much love. Let's do something live soon, and let's do something live in Vegas.
Yo, that sounds great, man.
Let's do it. And we'll get some ball in too. We'll play some ball. And someone said do it, challenge you to like a one-on-one basketball. I don't want to put that much time. I don't want to put that much time into official challenge, but I'll happily play because I love.
Oh, you and me? No. Let's play 2-on-2 against some other clown team.
Okay, that sounds like a really good idea. We'll crush it. All right, bud. Much love, man. It was definitely one of the most fun podcasts I ever did, man. I'm happy we got to do it, my friend.
Me too, buddy. Thanks for having me.
Guys on YouTube, much love as always. Much love. A lot of comments, a lot of questions. If you guys grind out the entire time, you guys are fucking crazy. But I love you guys. I'm out. Peace out. Olivier, talk with you soon, man.
All right, buddy.
Peace.
Peace.
Adios.